Sports Division in conjunction with TVRE Channel 29 present from the Lilac City Ice Arena on North Addison. In Spokane with your host Kim Bolton and Tom Mabelson. Tonight's game, the Spokane Flames versus the Grand Forks Border Bruins. Tonight's game brought to you by
PM on Channel 31.
Visit Carousel Beauty and Apparel on Spokane's near north side to keep you in step with today's ever-changing styles. Let Reba, Darla, Bonnie, and Eileen help you achieve that special look at prices you can't afford. Complete perms range from $20 to $26. Haircuts and shampoo set $6.50. Using only the best in beauty care products. So take a fashion ride on the carousel located at East 1919 Mission in Spokane or call for an appointment today at 534-2704.
Sports Division, I'm Kim Bolton along with Tom Mabelson. Tom, we had the All-Star game over up in Creston over the holidays there. Could you tell us about that?
Well, I understand the West, Western Division won. And the fact was that there were a number of Spokane players that we had talked in a previous telecast who had been selected, three of them, and I understand there were a number of changes for several reasons.
Right, there was. Kurt Nelson played for Keith Blair. Keith was out with the flu. Charlie Goodwin played for Jim McLeod. Jim McLeod wasn't back from vacation yet. And, of course, Bobby Stolz did play. And in that game, Kurt Nelson scored the first goal for the East team, which made him feel pretty good, I'm sure. Charlie Goodwin got a couple of assists, and Bobby Stolz got one assist, and Bobby Stolz was voted one of the top 10 players in the game. So we do have some hockey players here in Spokane.
I understand McLeod may not be coming back. There seems a little bit of a foggy issue there. Is that correct?
That's correct. I haven't got into that yet, so I'll have to dwell into that a little bit more and see how it develops. I'm sure that we want him back. He was a very good player, and we would like to see him on the ice.
Now, this is the only hockey game in the town, and we have to remember it's Tier 3 junior hockey, and there's an awful lot of people, of course, who have been disappointed in Tier 1 hockey during the last two seasons. Of course, it went bankrupt and left town. And so it becomes important that may we tell a lot of our viewers that we invite them to come out and see one of the Flames games to a Saturday night event particularly. And we encourage all those people who are connected with the electronic media and the press to maybe give the Flames as much coverage as they can, even though it's only one of the many sports in town.
That's correct. We do have a real class hockey game here, and it is the only Class B hockey game in town, and it's very good hockey. We'd like to see everybody come out and enjoy the game. We really enjoy it. I know I enjoyed very much last week with you there.
That was a lot of fun. One thing about this team now, I want to say completely a Spokane-based team, and I may be wrong with one player, but the major number of the players are Spokane boys, and I think that's super.
That's correct. They are mostly, all except for one, all from Spokane, and it's great that we can have some players that can even go up into the All-Star game and play outstanding hockey up there, and the people from Canada are beginning to notice our hockey game down here.
You know, there are hundreds of kids playing hockey here from the squirts up to the juniors with the bantams, etc., and it gives them a chance to shoot at something without having to leave town to go to a junior team.
That's correct. These boys here, they come out and play hockey. They've chosen to play hockey over basketball or football, which is probably the glory sports in our media. And we really feel privileged to come out here and film these guys playing their hearts out, because they don't get the recognition that a lot of the other players. And these guys are every bit as much professionals as some of the best football and basketball players in this town. One thing I would like to run over, last night, Keith Blair got two goals against who'd they play last
Nelson
night?
Nelson Maple. You're okay.
Okay, Nelson. Right. That was right. Okay. And Mike Green got two goals. Brian Shaw got one into an empty net. And Charlie Goodwin got one goal last night. They did win 6-4, so they are back on the winning track again.
And it sounds like an exciting game when you pull a goaltender to try to get the equalizer, even though it backfires and it ends up with a two-goal margin instead of the tie game that Nelson was hoping for.
Right. It was. It wasn't like Spokane run away with it. It was. They did pull a goalie, and they did get an extra goal in there. So, for Area Sports Division, I'm Kim Bolton, along with Tom Mabelson. See you later.
Do you have any questions about hockey or the Spokane Flames hockey players? Area Sports Division would like to answer your questions about hockey, hockey rules, and the Flames. If you're wondering why an official made that certain call, or anything about the Spokane Flames history or players, drop us a line and we'll try to answer your questions. We will select the best question each week and answer it on the air during the game. If your question is selected, we'll send you two free tickets to the next Flame home game. So get a pencil and paper and write to us at HNS, care of Aries Video Sports, East 2810 29th, Spokane, Washington, 99203. If you write to us, we'll do our best to answer your question. And don't forget, you can watch exciting hockey in Spokane every Wednesday night right here on Channel 29 TVRE.
City Ice Arena. I'm Kim Bolton. Tonight's game pits the Spokane Flames along with the Grand Forks Border Bruins. Tom Mabelson will be picking up the play at the center ice in a minute. Let's see here. Spokane's record at the moment is standing at 13 and 14. 13 wins, 14 losses, no ties. Grand Forks is at 4 and 24, no ties. Grand Forks won last night 9-8 in overtime. With the play-by-play, here's Tom Mabelson.
Okay, Dennis LaRue, thanks, Kim. Dennis LaRue, the referee, brings the teams to center ice, and Buddy Bodman starts Jones at center with Kaziski on the right wing and Keith Blair in the left wing. From the faceoff by Jones, it's cleared back inside the Spokane zone and out to center ice by Ewers inside the Bruins zone. Now the Grand Forks team come to center ice. A long shot from the right wing, and it's tipped wide, and it brought out by Ewers along the line. Kaziski on the right wing, up over the Canadian line, and it's steered away, but not in time. Jones coming in, and it was wide, but the corner was open. Jones going in for it, trying to get it cleared, and it's number 12 for the Grand Forks Border Bruins, and that's going to be a mouthful as we go along. It's cleared down to center ice, and you see Shaw and Ewers on defense for Spokane in front of the starting netminder, Sam Froby. It's at neutral territory. That's Jones playing at number six, the centerman on the starting line. He starts out at center, winding up a long shot, bounced off the chest of the Bruin netminder, Bob Maul. And finally, the Canadians clear it to center ice. Now the attack. Sims going in over the line, as there's a broken stick in the play that hasn't been picked up yet. Now they come out. This is 12 for Spokane. Mike Kaziski going up over on the right wing and shooting. And it's stopped on the short side by Bob Maul, the Bruins netminder. Spokane player bowled over from behind as Shaw let a rising shot go from just inside the blue line.
Well, we're going to have a discussion, Tom.
Good glove save by the Canadian netminder, and it was a rising shot, and it would be about probably crossbar height had it not been played. So now let's see who we have. We're going to have a lot of changes tonight, but it looks like Grand Forks probably. We're down to about 13 players. That was Holden out there with Poindexter and Goodwin on the other wing as it was at center ice. And they have Corey Bowles on defense at this time with Scott Kine. It's cleared up over the line by Dan Holden. Now it's brought back by Grand Forks to the Flames line, rather, and shooting as Bowles stopped that try. Coming out now is Poindexter. A nice play off the boards to center ice to the Canadian line. Holden in front. They centering it and hit the back of a defenseman's skate. That's Goodwin in the corner. They go back of the goal, trying to punch it to the near side. They do, as Pocheck was in there for the Bruins, and it comes to the Grand Fork blue line now to center ice. A long shot by Dempster is right on, and Froby had no trouble with it. Bowles trying to get it out, gets it to Goodwin on the far side. Three of them come to center ice. A lead pass intended for Poindexter, who got him in the backside there. Now Goodwin trying to get something going as Bodman changes his team up. Green is out there now. He got two goals last night in that 6-4 win over Nelson in the Canadian City. Grand Forks get it out off the boards to center ice. Kine back at his own line. A little bit of miscommunication there as they have right out there now for Grand Forks. Spokane's Kurt Nelson starts out. They center it in front there. There's a delayed penalty coming up, as there was some interference going on in front of the Grand Forks goal. And LaRue comes over to the penalty timekeeper's bench. Well, it looked like he gave the, I'm not sure whether he gave the high sticking or the interference.
It
sign.
Was interference, Tom.
Yeah, that was the call down
against
the
number
goal.
15 for Grand Forks. And that'll be Rob Tack.
Okay. So we have our first penalty of the game. 2 minutes for interference. And the penalty was 3:03. So the Flames a power play. Ewers letting one go from just inside the blue line at the point. Back of the goal, that's Bailey with it off the boards to Ewers. A screenshot coming in. Deflected off the Bruins player. And it's now number six in there. Kelly Argato has a backhander there by Spokane's Nelson. Almost put it in. They put it in. Nelson lost his stick.
And the play is a little ragged right now up to center ice. Now the Flames will start again. Four of them come to the line. No stick. Nelson has no stick, so he's going to play a little soccer there, and does. And that's a little pushing around in there. There's a penalty coming up there. And it's going to be against the Grand Fork team, probably. Yes, for elbowing, I believe.
That's number 22. He's skating right off the ice. He's not even waiting any time. That's Kelly Sims for Grand Forks.
Well, this is a big break for the Flames because they will have a two-man advantage for 1 minute and 11 seconds, then for roughly 49 seconds, a man advantage, barring any further penalties to either team. That's Jones at center. Our cameraman, Jim, had you coming down the back of Bobby Jones there. Another change from the Spokane bench. They have Bowles and Kine in defense. As it comes back to Kine, and playing it off the boards, and finally Kaziski couldn't hold it in there, and it's dumped down the length of the ice to kill off some of that precious penalty time. Now the Flames come out of their own zone along the right wing. Jones, the centerman, up over the Canadian blue line, going to the corner, put it around the boards back of the goal. Blair is out there, that's number 9, and that's 19 Bulls, who couldn't contain it, but Blair does, and shoots one wide. Jones bangs that, they score! It bobbled off the pads, I believe, of the netminder Maul, and Jones has a power play goal. And so that we would charge to the original first penalty to tack. Jones should get credit. We'll wait for the official call at 4:26.
That was an excellent play there. Keith Blair took the shot. It went a little bit wide around, hit the boards, come back out in front. Jones was standing there, took a shot. Hit the goalie in the pads, bounced off the pads, hit the goal post, and bounced in.
Right. So we have 4.5 minutes gone in the game. Two penalties to Grand Forks. One has been costly so far as the Flyers have scored. And now the Flames have scored. Now the Flames come out of their own zone. Kaziski ragging the puck, turns around to get reorganized again with Bowles off the boards. Here's Kaziski coming in and shooting. And a love chest save by Bob Maul in the Canadian goal.
Okay, Tom, that goal was scored by Bobby Jones, of course. It was a power play goal. It came at 4:26, assisted by number 9, Keith Blair, and number 19, Corey Bowles.
Very good, Kim. And it was a good goal, too.
Yes, it was.
That's the type of a play you must score when you have a two-man advantage.
That's correct. They did take advantage of it. Grand Forks come out and got a little bit down, got in the penalty box, and Spokane took advantage.
Shaw's try is stopped by the blade of the Grand Forks player. And I don't have a 12 on my list, so we'll do some checking there. Bounces out to center ice right along the boards below us. And he's apparently a left winger. They keep it in there as Argato put it back of the goal. 14:40 left in the first period. The Flames lead 1-0. 30 seconds left in that penalty. As Poindexter has Goodwin with him. Goodwin going the corner now to Poindexter. Score! They bang it in. A good shot as some shoving by in front of the goal. And there was a good play because Holden was getting ready in front in anticipation of a pass. You go to the front of the goal. And I think the netminder probably was keeping the eye on that winger, holding number 14 in front, and Poindexter, number 15, let the shot go. And it's 2-0. Two power play goals. And again, penalties are costly. So that goal came at the 5:29 mark. And Kim will have the scoring for you in just a minute.
For the finest in Cox, from Cox Cable TV, the finest in classics and fine arts, every evening at 6 p.m. on Channel 31.
Okay, we have Shaw out there with Ewers on defense in front of Sam Froby for the Flames. They jam in, back of the hole comes in front. The puck came in front. And it's now Danny Holden turning inside his own line on the left wing. A rink-wide pass at center to Charlie Goodwin. It rolled in front on the one-inch edge. Now it's brought out by the Bruins, but not all the way. And the Bruins will try it again, and they do get it to neutral territory. That was Shaw. You saw the Spokane right defenseman. Now the Bruins start out again. Dempster had it. got nowhere. It's punched up like a little pop-up fly there and ended up in front to the corner, deep inside the goal here, the blue line rather. Here's a try by Green, as Bowles is going to get a penalty. Looked like he threw the right elbow at the Grand Forks player who is along the boards there, and that's the indication from the referee, Dennis LaRue, the two linesmen, John Aitken and Dwight Baker.
That's what we're going to have. We're going to have an elbow against number 19, Corey Bowles. And that goal was scored by number 15, Rod Poindexter. It was a power play goal, scored at 5:29, assisted by number 10, Charlie Goodwin, and number 11, Jim Ewers.
So the Grand Forks team will have an opportunity now to see what they can do with their power play. They put 22, Sims, who's been in the penalty bench once so far tonight, on the left wing. And again, we're going to have to find out who number 12 is. That's the centerman in this power play. And the extra man, number 9, Tim McNabb, was the late addition. Okay, right. Brian Hudikoff, yeah, I have that one place, and I got him in 10 another. Very good. And he was the starting centerman. Well, they gave me number 12 for him there, so that's why we've got a... Now the Bruins start out. That's Hudikoff trying to roll around the defense, off the boards, back to the point, to Rasmussen. Pad save by Froby as the Grand Forks defenseman let a good one go in from the point. Here you coming in again and shooting off of Stolz's stick and into the crowd. Just checking again. We have two Hudikoffs on our lineup, but only one playing.
The one Hudikoff is off. He's going to play tonight in a smaller league, the next league down. He's pretty
juvenile.
Young.
Juvenile.
Right. There
There's
you go.
Tournament going, I think.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Take that fashion ride on the carousel. Carousel Beauty and Apparel, East 1919 Mission, for complete beauty care with service and prices that will make you and your pocketbook smile. Call 534-2704. That's 534-2704 for an appointment today.
Bruins coming in front. They have a power play for another minute and five. Back to the point, back to Rasmussen, a shot right on, and a good stick save by Froby there. That's Hudikoff back of the Spokane goal, trying to get a man set up. It comes to the winger, Sims on that play. Hudikoff trying to get it set up again, and it hit the shaft of Brian Shaw's stick as he put along the ice there. A shot is deflected. Rasmussen trying to backhand in front. Does a second try, and Froby had two saves there. Now it's brought out nicely by Keith Blair. The winger moves to center. Comes up to the blue line and shoots off the back screen. Covered up there by Sims for the Grand Forks team. And Ewers and Sean defense cover up at the red center ice line. Ewers did a low down drop there with against Wakefield, and they were having a little bit of discussion there as they went by each other. Now the Bruins starting out. They call themselves the Border Bruins. Here's Blair coming up over with Kaziski, and the shot is wide. The Flames change on the go. Kine racing back for it as he's chased down there by Tim McNabb, number 9. Here's Kaziski, couldn't clear. Oh, I don't know whether it hit the mask or not of the netminder Froby. It looked like it was almost tipped down by a high stick by the Canadian player in front. Now back come the Flames. Here's Jones coming in. He took a slap shot, which was way wide, and that's where he should have used the wrist shot. Now up to the Flames blue line. A shot screened wide. They put it back in front again. That was McNabb doing the centering for the Bruins. Bowles cleared but not out along the boards. Here's coming in front, and a shot whizzed wide as Argateau let one go. They're coming in again and shooting. It's right in front. A stick save by Froby from Hudikoff's shot.
Boy, that was excellent play there. And yes, Sam Froby did take that off the mask. I seen him grab his nose there and kind of pull his mask back on. He's rubbing her now. He got hit right in the mask with that one. How fast has that puck traveled in there, Tom?
Well, I think they've clocked it up to about 100 miles an hour, and it has been known to be driven through a good size, they tell you, a plank, whether that's an inch plank, I don't know, but it's a coming at you.
Yeah, it was definitely moving there, too. He took
right.
A hard one.
Right. From the faceoff, that's Bowles, number 19, round the boards to the near side. Danny Holden fighting in there with number 6, Argato. And we have a stoppage. 2-0 is the score if you joined us late. For our viewers, the Spokane Flames leading the Grand Forks Border Bruins. Face off there with Poindexter against number 25, Wishlow. And it's right in front of the timekeeper's bench. Here they go now. Here's Poindexter coming in with Goodwin, tipping it wide. A nice play, though. Holden changes his wings and then thumps the Canadian defenseman over in the corner. As Wright gets it out to the blue line, it's kept in there, though, along the boards. Bowles at his own blue line, tipped at center by Poindexter. It was an onside play, as they have number 19, Pocheck, being checked in there by, well, that's Charlie Goodwin now, with a little arm flinging by both of them. Goodwin is 10, and number 14 is Gail Holden's youngster. But I think he's about 16 now.
Well, you know, as long as we're talking about Charlie Goodwin, we might as well wish him a happy birthday. When this is aired on Wednesday night, it'll be his birthday, his 16th birthday.
The player.
Yes.
Well, as soon as you said 16, right. Okay, good enough. So we have two names in hockey on the ice tonight. Fathers are successful people in the area and played some fine hockey here for a great many years. Here the Tack coming in and shooting, and a good save by Sam Froby, and he just said some stand-up hockey there and faced the checker and the shooter. It's back at center ice now. Argato putting it to the Flames' blue line, and sticks are starting to come up. They're starting to run each other and throw out the knee, and if that happens, we're going to have some penalties, some slashing back and forth there. Now they're coming in. It was a glove pass, I saw, thought, by the Bruins player who put it ahead to his winger.
There's 9:16 left in the first period. The score is 2-0, Spokane over Grand Forks. This is Spokane's first meeting with Grand Forks this year. They'll have one more in February on the 5th.
Grand Forks apparently having some difficulty this year, not as strong as they would like to be. That's a good community up there. Have you ever been up there?
No, I haven't. I think I passed through there once, but I was on a motorcycle and I was headed south.
Very good agricultural area and a key part of the economy in that spot. There's some grabbing there, actually some holding, as Green was held, and there's no, we look for the raised arm on a delayed penalty, but no, sir. Now the Green is coming up in front and chipping it just off the corner of the goal, as he was set up by Nelson, a screenshot by Kine. Now a try by Bailey, and he's bowled over by number 14, Wakefield. They're coming in front, a bouncing pass, and then the shot. And there was some activity back of the play, but behind the referee, Dennis LaRue.
Yeah, who was it there? One of the Spokane players caught a stick right in the face, and he didn't like it too much. He went over there to talk about it, and that was all behind the referee, though.
Jerry Queering is the coach for the Grand Forks Border Bruins. Buddy Bodman, the mentor for the Spokane Flames. That's Jones, number 6, putting it in front. It's all loose. It's bouncing around there. And they start to shove and push.
Now, this is where Spokane don't need a penalty.
That's right.
And it looks like he might get in there and get one. It's Kaziski in there.
Well, let's see if he's going to bring him off. The two of them, I think Kaziski's going to come off.
And
at least a Spokane penalty. And LaRue wants to take the game in tow early. Yep, both going to be shorthanded. So Spokane has its second penalty of the game. And the Bruins from Grand Forks have their third. 14, right, okay. Come in with that anytime you want,
okay.
Kim.
That was Breck Wakefield that went off for the Bruins. They're both going to be sitting out for 2 minutes.
At 11:27. So both teams are man short. Blair, Jones, Ewers, and Stolz out there. All four up inside the Canadian blue line. Blair got part of it. And now the Grand Forks really can't call them a sextet here because they're shorthanded. Come out up over the blue line with McNabb being partially grabbed. It comes back to Margoteau. It's put in the corner back of the Flames goal. Sims trying to get something going, but he's checked by Stolz. Now Stolz coming out. He has brings it out with Ewers to the blue line to center ice with Jones. It's punched back, and there could have been a 2-on-1 try for Grand Forks, but they didn't take advantage of it. Blair to Jones, but it's well offside as Jones crossed from center to the left wing as Blair, the left winger, moved to the center ice spot as he crossed the blue line, and Jones was already trapped inside for an offside infraction.
Okay, both those penalties that we got there at the 11:27 mark were for roughing. And that was at Brett Wakefield and Mike Kaziski, and they'll be off for another minute and 22 seconds.
Both teams playing a man short. Flames leading 2-0 over Grand Forks, Border Bruins. Now Grand Forks come to the attack. That's McNabb. He still has it. Drops it back to the point to Argato. A screenshot. And it's stopped by Froby and brought out by Jones. He comes to center. Pass was, I thought it was offside. Blair was. Now you hear the whistle. Blair was just a stride ahead of the play over the blue line on the left side.
At Carousel Beauty and Apparel, you can find the top in casual and sportswear, plus coordinated accessories to complement your wardrobe. So take that fashion ride on the carousel, Carousel Beauty and Apparel, East 1919 Mission, or call for an appointment at 534-2704.
Blair, wrist shot, bounced off the right shoulder, chest area of the netminder Maul, and they try to gobble it. Here's Kine shooting one, deflected over the net. They try to roll it back in front. Blair trying to get Jones set up. Now Jones has it. Nobody in front, though, as they try to get... Corey Bulls try to get in front. That's Kine now turning around. Now screening it. And a pad save. Here's an open goal to shoot at. And he hit the post as Blair let one go from the right wing, his opposite side. Grand Forks coming back as McNabb let a hard shot go, but a good glove save by Froby as he dropped. It's in the far corner. That's Tim McNabb putting it in front. And it's steered out to the point by netminder Sam Frobe. And Kine and McNabb for Grand Forks tie each other up there. Kine for Spokane gets it to Blair. Blair winds up and lets a long one go as the netminder came way out to stop it and had some trouble with it. Now Grand Forks turning inside their own zone. A nice bit of stick handling there by the centerman Argato, and then he's hit hard and thumped, and the play is brought back out to center ice. Sticks
both
come a little high. Go ahead.
Both teams are back to full strength now.
Okay, the double minor for roughing as the gate to the Bruins was open there, and Poindexter goes back inside his own zone to regroup. We have Goodwin out there. Ewers coming to attack with Holden hustling in front. That's Ewers putting it back to Poindexter, who overskated it. The Canadians come back out of their own zone. They come to center ice. We have Tack going in back of the goal, watched by Brian Shaw of the Flames. In to help out there is number 4, Wright, who I believe was a defenseman. And it's off the boards to neutral territory. Holden, number 14, Poindexter, 15, and Goodwin, 10. They come up 2-on-1. Here's Poindexter to hold, Goodwin. And there, I think Poindexter should have shot and let young Charlie Goodwin look for a possible rebound. It's bouncing inside the Canadian defensive zone, around the boards, the Bruins put it. And it's out to neutral territory there. The Bruins coming back. Tack trying to get it in the corner to Wakefield. Back of the goal, they try to get it in front. And the Flames cover up. That was number 15, Mike Poindexter. It's kept in there to the far corner. Ewers coming out to center ice. Goodwin fighting along the boards. Two of them fall. And it's steered to center, an onside play. And that's number 14, Bert Wakefield. A shot, a good save by Froby along the ice, a stick save. Kine in front of his own goal, giving it to Ewers. A long shot. They must be wanting to change here. That's what's happening. Ewers coming off, and the Flames change on the goal. We have Corey Bulls out in defense. Who's the other one with Brian Shaw?
Ted Bailey.
Ted Bailey on the left wing. Nelson and 27 Mike Green out there. So that line has been completed, the change. Going to be an icing call here. Now let's see now. Yeah, we don't wait to touch it. It's automatically icing.
Yeah, they're having some real hard checking down there. The referee's going to have to get a hold of this game. Everybody seems to be starting up grudges already. Aries Sports Division does complete coverage of any local sporting event, so don't let your team be left out. Call Aries Video Enterprises at 534-7121.
Manager for the Spokane Flames, Gene Nelson, the trainer, Ham Hamilton. And have you seen Ham on the air a number of times with Kim Bolton. Back of the Spokane's goal, Nelson reverses his direction, then comes out on the near side. Brought along the boards by Mike Green. Ends up inside the, not only blue line, but went over the Grand Forks red line, so it's going to be called back. Icing charged against the Spokane Flames with 3:47 left in the period, and the Flames leading by a solid 2-0 margin on two power play goals.
Yeah, the only place Spokane's really scored here and got an advantage was on those penalties, and when Spokane had a player in the penalty box, Grand Forks certainly couldn't take advantage of it.
And I believe that Sam Froby in goal for the Flames has had more saves than the Canadian netminder Bob Maul.
I believe that's correct.
Green trying to get it out. It's kept in there by Wakefield. Back of the Spokane goal. Wishlow fighting in there with Bulls. Four of them jam in there. And we have a whistle.
Well, we're going to bring her off and face her out here in the front.
There's a score, 2-0 for the Flames over the Border Bruins.
Yeah, the Border Bruins have had three penalties, and Spokane has had two penalties in the game so far.
Facing off to the right of Sam Froby in the Flames goal. That's dropped. The puck is dropped. That was Wishlow, the centering man. And then Froby has a save there as he went down on his knees.
I believe Froby's going to come up probably about 2-1 as compared to the Grand Forks goalie on saves.
They've had enough shots that they've almost deserve at least one goal, but Sam has some other ideas.
Yes, he's done some excellent playing tonight.
But he wants them to keep those ideas, too. Kine back of the goal to Ted Bailey, number 8. Racing way to center for a lead pass is Kurt Nelson. It's too far out of his reach, and it's called back for icing.
Well, Kurt almost got out there on that one.
Looked like it was a little out of his reach, and he really hadn't picked up the momentum that he needed to finish it off. That play started on Spokane's side of center ice and ended up on that red line you can't see from here. Actually, we have all the lines are red tonight. The blue lines are red lines tonight, and that's, I don't know why they have it that way, but that's the way it is. And I'm not coming out early and paint those lines. They jam in along the boards there. As Nelson, you saw, bowled over by Moutsos, and the puck bounced into the crowd in the air. A little pop-up fly.
And Corey Bowles is doing his job tonight on defense. He's getting in there and checking real hard, even forechecking.
Got him down. He knows I'm not saying Carey, I'm saying Corey.
Very good. Well, now if we just get everybody else right, I heard that the rink announcer, Paul, down there, he gave Brett, he has it spelled down here, Brent.
That's so, Bert. There's Bert, a change. Yeah, right. That's a misprint. I talked to Jerry Queering, and he said it's Bert. So there's a number of errors there in the program. Okay, that's Kurt Nelson racing away as he has Mike Green with him, and he couldn't handle a pass. You saw that. And it ended up in the Canadian corner. That's Bailey fighting in there against two Bruin players, and they hold it out there.
Well, we're going to have a complete change of lines on both sides with 2:48 left in the first period. Spokane's leading 2-0 over Grand Forks.
Burgundy is the dark color for the Flames, right?
That's correct. Okay. Burgundy and gold.
And the color combination that the Border Bruins have is the same as the Boston Bruins. You saw a screenshot coming in. It never reached the netminder. A second try is wide as we have two players falling in there. Kaziski, and I thought the other one was 27. If it is, it's Rasmussen. And he is the captain tonight for the Canadians. Bobby Stolz is the captain for the Flames. The Bruins come out at center. A bouncing puck here. They're coming in on the right wing. I think it's McNabb going in. We have, unless we see the back, we can't tell from here. It's put in front. And it was McNabb, and a good save in there, but a good shot and a good try by the Bruin player, Tim McNabb. He had trouble with it again. Now it's brought out by Kaziski. Rink wide pass by to Blair. Blair and Kaziski back to Kaziski. A backhander. Off the, where is it? He has it again. He's bowled over there, or bumped at least, and he couldn't get that second shot away. Kaziski back of the goal to Bobby Jones, who looks like quite a tall player from here. Keith Blair now out in front, and it's taken by number 12, Brian Hudikoff, the centerman. The Flames keep it in there. Blair intended, comes out to the blue line, but not over. Ewers putting it in front. Now Jones winding up. He scores! Oh, I thought that went in.
I thought that
puck went in.
I believe it was a score. I think it went through the net. They're checking out the net right now.
That puck went in. It went in a good 10 inches inside of the
Definitely.
Post.
From where I'm sitting up here, it definitely looked like it went right through the net. And
that
we're
was Jones
having...
taking the shot now, if I just go back.
Yes, it was.
It went through inside, a good 10 inches inside the pipe.
Well, we're going to have him come down here and give the score, I believe. We're going to have to wait for the official's word.
Yeah, I think he's called it a goal. I think six got it. The shot was screened as far as the goalie is concerned, but Jones had about 6 or 8 inches of space to pick it, and that's where he put it, at 18-21.
Okay, at 18-21, that was Bobby Jones with the goal, at Keith Blair with the assist, and Jim Ewers with the other one.
So both Ewers and Blair each have two assists so far tonight, and Jones has two goals.
That's correct.
So it's now 3-0 for the Spokane Flames over the Grand Forks Bruins. And there was no doubt from our vantage point that that puck was in.
Definitely, but it didn't even slow up. It went right through a hole in the net, and they had to go down there and fish for it and find it to make sure that it was there. And it looks like they're trying to repair the net right now to get that out of there. I don't even think the goalie's seen that. It went right on by him so fast,
right,
he didn't even get a look at it.
Okay, they've got their housework done there back of that net. That's a pretty strong mesh, too, you know, Kim.
Yeah, it looks like a number 4 1/4 gill net there.
Yeah. Okay, Bodman's puts Goodwin out there with Danny Holden and Poindexter at center with Kine. And let's see, we're seeing Pregages out there for the first time tonight, I think. Number 21, Pete Pregages. Hey, there's a family that's been active in hockey. His dad has been super supporting hockey. Here's a try by Poindexter. Point blank range, you saw it. A good save and clear to the corner and out to center ice. Sims there giving Kine a little bit of shove, and Sims broke his stick in the play. Now Rasmussen starts out, the defenseman getting it off the boards inside the Spokane line. McNabb gets it from the Spokane defender, and it's now brought out by Mike Poindexter. A rink-wide pass intended for Charlie Goodwin. He'll be taken out of the play. It was a little ahead of him.
Ooh.
Argato was the man who took him out of the play there, and they fall back of the boards. It comes to the point to Pregages. He put along the boards to the corner, and they're starting to rough it up a little bit, particularly after the play has gone by. That's Goodwin pinning his man up against the boards, and then there was a late hit there.
And we're going to have a little discussion. The officials getting in there to separate them apart. They are hitting a little bit harder. There's only 34 seconds left in the final period here, and Spokane is leading now 3-0. Over Grand Forks. Grand Forks is wanting to slow down the action a little bit.
Young Charlie Goodwin, the son of Charlie and Judy Goodwin. You know, I worked the broadcasts and radio in the Western International Hockey League for a number of years, and had the pleasure of working with Charlie Goodwin. He was a busy man. He had his full-time job, and he was coaching the junior team at that time, too.
Yeah, that would keep you busy, I'm sure.
I thought I was busy. He was twice as busy. Did a good job in all departments, too, incidentally.
Mm-hmm. Well, Spokane is keeping control of the puck most of the time here. They're getting off a few shots here in the final stages of this period. They had an excellent chance to get a couple shots in there before.
Maybe a bench penalty here. Oh, misconduct. You see what happened to the bench? Maybe, I don't know what his T sign is, and I've never seen that in hockey. I guess I'm going to have to learn something here.
Bench minor.
Well, I've never seen him use the T as a bench minor. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, that was to number 27.
I always think of basketball when you talk about technicals, you know. We've covered a lot of bench minors, but there we saw it.
Grand Forks Border Bruins penalties at the 1926 mark.
We're in the last minute of play, 34 seconds, and for either team, the last minute of the period is always a crucial one. You let up and get scored on, or you give it the extra effort and try to score while the other team is let up. Okay. Back of the side of the goal. That's Shaw back from Ewers. Ewers coming to the... Gets it to Spokane's Mike Green. Nelson in there fighting along with number 19, Pocheck of the Grand Forks team.
Okay, both those penalties came at the 19:26 mark. It was number 9, Tim McNabb. That was for boarding, 2 minutes. And number 27, Tad Rasmussen, and he got unsportsmanlike conduct, 2 minutes.
Okay. Well, again, the Flames have a two-man advantage, and the only break that the Bruins may have here is that the two minors are split by the first and second penalty, and so they won't have that full gung-ho 2 minutes going on it. Two seconds left.
That's correct. Two seconds left.
All right, here's Blair with a shot. And the horn goes to end the period as Bob Moll has the save. And they start to shove him, push and shove. You see 27 there, Spokane's Mike Green. There's 6, Bobby Jones, just to identify some of them in the thick of it. The period is over with the score. Spokane Flames 3, Grand Forks Border Bruins nothing.
We had in a first period of action between the Spokane Flames and the Grand Forks Border Bruins, we had 3 goals by Spokane. That first goal come from number 6, Bobby Jones. It was a power play goal. It was scored at the 4:26 mark. He was assisted by number 9, Keith Blair, and number 19, Corey Bowles. The second goal came from number 15, Rod Poindexter. He was assisted by number 10, Charlie Goodwin, and number 11, Jim Ewers. And that came at the 5:29 mark in the period. And the last goal was scored also by number 6, Bobby Jones. He was assisted by number 9, Keith Blair again. There's that line, Jones and Blair, and number 11, Jim Ewers, assisted on that. That came at the 18:21 mark. And then in penalties in that period, first penalty came from number 15, Rod Track, for the Border Bruins. That was for interference. He got 2 minutes at the 3:03 mark. And number 22, Kelly Sims, got 2 minutes at the 3:52 mark for elbowing. And then Spokane's number 19, Corey Bowles, got an elbowing penalty, 2 minutes at the 6:31 mark. And number 14, Brett Wakefield, for the Border Bruins, got a roughing penalty at the 11:27 mark. So that was for 2 minutes. Number 12, Mike Kaziski, for Spokane, got 2 minutes at the 11:27 mark for roughing. And number 9, Tim McNabb, for the Border Bruins, got 2 minutes for boarding at 19:26. And also at 19:26, number 27, Todd Rasmussen, I'll get it straight, got 2 minutes for an unsportsmanlike conduct. And saves in that period, Sam Proby had 10 for Spokane, and Bob Moll had 11 for the Border Bruins. Now, the Border Bruins were taking more shots in the early part of the period. Spokane come on in the later part and got in there. So, the score at the end of the first period, Spokane 3, the Border Bruins nothing. We'll be right back after a word from our sponsor.
See the performing arts, the visual arts, the lively arts, every night at 6 p.m. on Channel 31. Take a fashion ride on the carousel. Carousel Beauty and Apparel on Spokane's near north side. Save 50% on all casual and sportswear, including queen sizes. Mix and match with their fine selections. At the carousel, you'll find a unique selection of gifts and accessories for that special touch. Shop now at Carousel Beauty and Apparel, East 1919 Mission, and save 50%. Remember, 2 weeks only with great savings on casual and sportswear at the Carousel Beauty and Apparel.
Sports Division. It's a pleasure to have Buddy Bodman, the coach of the Spokane Flames, on our game and special feature tonight. Buddy, how about the standings in the East Kootenay Division?
Well, Tom, of course, you know Cranbrook is away out in front in the East. Last night, Kimberly beat Columbia Valley in Kimberly to move into second place. So that moves Columbia Valley down to third place, and we're 7 points out after beating Nelson in Nelson last night. So we're 7 points out of third in fourth place in our division, followed by Elk Valley and Crest in a lost spot.
It seems strange that the Spokane Flames is located in the Eastern Division. I think more that it should be in the West.
Well, we had a chance this year to get in that division to cut down on some traveling, and then they added... with the one club they added to keep the divisions even, we agreed to stay in the East.
Okay, Buddy, how about the injuries tonight?
Well, Tom, injuries seems to go in any sport, basketball, football, or whatever, seem to run in bunches, and we were going along fine. All of a sudden, Chris Sexton, during the Christmas break, goes skiing on his vacation and tears ligaments in his knee, and he's the first one out. Then Scotty Kine hurts his shoulder. Then last night, Mike Poindexter strains the ligaments in his knee in Nelson. Bobby Stolz picks up some stitches in his elbow. Jay Oyen hurts his shoulder in the exhibition game against Oak Bay. So they really do run in bunches, but we're lucky we got a little bit of depth to keep us going here.
Now, Kine and Stolz are going to be playing tonight. Is that correct?
Right. Scotty, this will be his first game back. Stoltz's dressed. We're going to spot him, see how the game goes. If we don't have to use him, we won't.
Okay, in Edmonton tonight, Gretzky had 3 points in the first three goals to lead Edmonton over Calgary at that point. Let's see how your Flames do tonight over the Grand Forks Border Bruins.
We don't have a 99, though, Tom.
That's all right. You do. Okay.
The Video Station. With an RCA Selectivision video recorder from the Video Station, you could be recording your favorite TV movies and saving them for future use. The Video Station has a movie library with 1,000 titles of all types for rent or sale. Add a RCA color camera to your video recorder and you can make your own home movies. Play it your way. Head into the Video Station at East 701 3rd Avenue, right across from Freeway Chevrolet.
TVRE, Channel 29, your Spokane real estate station.
Second period of action at the Lilac City Ice Arena. Spokane is leading 3-0 over the Grand Forks Border Bruins. And Tom, we had some real good hockey that period from Spokane. It looks like Grand Forks is playing a little bit chippy. Evened up on shots on goal before she was over.
I was surprised. Have we told our listeners and viewers?
Yeah, we did there in between periods, but we'll remind them again. Sam Froby had 10 saves, and Bob Mall for the Border Bruins had 11.
I find that hard to believe that Froby only had 10 saves, but that's not my job, and the goal judge keeps the count.
That's correct, and I think I did count at least 5 at one time. They're not too far apart, so maybe that isn't correct, but that's the way we got the score, so that's the way we're going to report it. And we're having a little bit of action down there in the Border Bruins goal. They're getting ready. The goaltender's checking out the light, seeing if she works.
And everybody's skating off, and we're getting ready for action.
Referee Dennis LaRue is at center ice. The Bruins will defend a zone to my left, the west end of the Lilac Ice Arena, and that puts the hometown Flames to my right, the east end. We have Sam Froby in goal for the Flames, Bob Mall in the nets for the Bruins, the Border Bruins from Grand Forks. Now Kaczynski carries up over the Canadian line. He still has it back to Ewers, number 11 at the point. Waits, screens one, it bounced in front off the netminder. They keep it on the blue line. Here's a screenshot, and it's wide of the goal. Keith Blair, number 9, out to Kaczynski. A shot off the upper arm of Mall, the Canadian netminder, and it's cleared by the Bruins out to center ice. 3-0 for Spokane over Grand Forks as we start the second period of play. That's defenseman Brian Shaw putting it in front to Blair. They bang it in.
That's
it was
Bobby.
Jones getting it right.
That was his hat trick tonight.
I wasn't sure who was going to take the shot there. There was Jones and Blair, and Jones end up being the one that got to the puck first.
Well, they're in the second period already, just in the start of the second period. Bobby Jones comes up with his hat trick tonight, and he's in the run for the money with Keith Blair on the points this season. So Bobby Jones pulls just a little bit closer.
Okay, another power play goal. That will nullify the remaining part of McNabb's boarding minor back late in the first period. So it's 4-0. You have to change it. They have up there. And we'll wait for the official scoring. There's the announcement in the background, and Kim will have it for you. As the play ended up back of the Spokane goal, and the face-off to Sam Froby's left.
Okay, now that goal came 40 seconds into the period. It was Bobby Jones' hat trick. It was scored on a power play, and he was assisted by number 2, Brian Shaw, and number 7, Jim Ewers. So Ewers now has 3 assists in tonight's game.
Okay, was it 7 or 11? Do you remember?
11.
Okay, fine. Very good. Now back comes Mike Poindexter. Deeks one man out. Comes up over the Grand Forks line, then fell to the ice. The Bruins fight in there with it. The puck is still loose. Finally, it's taken by Pocheck. Now he lost it. And the Bruins bring it out slowly. Down ice to center ice. Here's McNabb coming to the Flame blue line. And it's cleared out by Corey Bowles and brought back in again. Bowles has it again to Danny Holden, intended for Mike Poindexter. Now it's Kine off the boards, two-line pass infraction. It started inside the Flame blue line, was completed on the Grand Forks side of center ice.
Okay, we did have a penalty there to number 10, Charlie Goodwin, for Spokane. That was 2 minutes for elbowing, and it came 44 seconds into the period. The Grand Forks team is now back to full strength, and Spokane is going to have Charlie Goodwin sitting off for another minute and 18 seconds.
I was talking to Charlie and Judy during the intermission there. They were a little concerned the nature of the elbows and high sticking coming up. They were hoping that the officials would call it before it gets too rough. The Flames do some icing there, but it's not called because they are a man short. The Bruins come out. McNabb at center ice, up to the line, across with Sims. But McNabb couldn't get anywhere. Danny Holden coming back to center ice along the left boards. Try to get a pass to Mike Poindexter. The Canadians come back. That's Hudakoff up to the line in front and shooting wide as McNabb, Tim McNabb, number 9, let one go. It's back to right. Back to Brian Hudakoff. Kine jamming in there. The puck is frozen and we have a stoppage. You can't purposely stop that puck, but if you're being checked and you can't advance it, that's proper.
If you like movies, you'll like the video station. The video station has the most in movies and home video equipment. So call Bill or Dorothy at 534-8597 or visit the video station at East 701 3rd Avenue across from Freeway Chevrolet.
Kim Bolton and Tom Mabelson, Jim McCabe, along here covering it. A shot right on from the point and a good left pad save by Sam Froby. It's out at center ice. That was Wakefield turning for the Grand Forks team as it's now brought out to neutral territory by Nelson and then turned around and just golfed it against the boards. It rolled all the way around the corner to this side where we have Spokane's Mike Green trying to control it. Now Shaw puts it back in, but Green was not onside yet, so we have a stoppage. It'll be brought back outside. Let's see what they'll bring it back where the play started.
Okay, we have 4 seconds left in that penalty to Charlie Goodwin. He'll be back out on the ice in 4 seconds. 17:15 left in the second period. Spokane is leading 4-0.
We look across there at the Bruin bench. There you see the gate open there. 14 going in. That's Bert Wakefield. And they have 25 now. Wishlow at center for the Bruins. As Green is slowed down by the Bruins, they're coming out of their own zone. It'll be icing. Both teams at full strength. There's the raised arm of the linesman, the whistle. And it'll be all brought all the way down to the left of the Canadian netminder, number 29, Bob Maul.
For complete home video inventories at a price you can afford, call 534-7121 and get a free estimate. Aries Video Enterprises for all your video production needs.
Spokane Flames 4, Grand Forks Border Bruins 0. A screenshot and a stick save by Bob Maul. As the Bruins Wishlow brings it out to center ice along the left boards. Coming over, nice effort, but it got ahead of him as he was slowed down head-on by Brian Shaw. It's back of the goal. It's centered in front, and it's brought out now by Green. Green to Bailey in back of the play. We had two people mixing it up. Spokane's number 11, Ewers. And then we had Ewers tangling with their Grand Forks, Mutsos. Number 11.
Well, I think that was a little uncalled for by Mutsos there. He come in and took a cheap one at Charlie, or excuse me, at Jim Ewers there.
We'll see what comes up. 3:23 is the time of the goal. I think just a minor to each team, one penalty apiece.
That's going to be a minor to each team for roughing, 2 minutes each. It's number 11, Jim Ewers for Spokane. And number 25, Rob Wishlow for the Border Bruins.
A little more ice to play hockey, but you normally don't get as good a hockey with five-a-side as you do when you have the full complement of six players. That's Corey Bowles bringing it out of his own zone. He has Jones with him. It's completed to Blair at center, up over the line on the left side. Blair centering it in front, and it's taken by Grand Forks. They bring it to center ice. As we have Argateau coming up over the line, a little high sticking in front, and the Flames come back. Blair and Jones 2-on-1. Jones going in. He shoots, and it was wide. He elected to shoot instead of passing, but the defender started to cover Blair, so probably that was the better play. Now the Bruins coming up over the line. Both teams a man short as number 6, Kelly Argateau, tried to do something with it. It's kept in there by Grand Forks. 15, Rob Tack putting it back in the Spokane goal. There looked like some interference there before the play got there by Corey Bowles, so I'm not sure who'll get the penalty as they both kind of bump, but I think Bowles will come off, which will mean that there will be a power play for the Bruins.
Okay, that was number 19, Corey Bowles. 2 minutes for interference.
He actually checked the player, Kim, before the puck and the player, the Grand Forks player became part of the play, and that's why he did the interfering.
Okay, that comes at the 4:25 mark in the period, so Spokane will be skating a man short. Grand Forks will have to try to take advantage of this power play.
Okay, Spokane 2 men short, Grand Forks 1 man short, which means the Grand Forks Border Bruins have a power play. Kine, the defenseman, takes it slowly to center ice, picks up speed. He's got a 2-on-1 advantage, a shot. I don't know if he knew Stolz was with him coming down the slot. They fight in for the puck there, picked up by Sims of the Canadian Grand Forks team. Sims coming out slowly down the middle to his blue, to center ice, to the Flames blue line. 3 of them across, try to get a drop pass. Nicely covered by Kine, though, by the blade of his stick, and it failed to materialize. Now it's number 27, Rasmussen, from the point, screenshot wide, about 2 feet off the ice. To the near side, Sims waits. He has Rasmussen open at the other point. That's where the play goes. There's the shot as it came off the boards. And Nab didn't know it, but he had trouble with the puck, and he had half the net to shoot with. Here's a try by Sims. A pad save by Froby. And they're bringing back in Rasmussen, a backhand. They bang it. They put it in. No, it didn't go in. The puck did not go in. And a breakaway there for Kaziski, and it's cleared out. I thought the puck went in, but it didn't. They had three tries.
It should have went in.
Yes, it sure should have. Here is now the Grand Bruins taking a shot. They bang at it again from the short side, but Froby had it covered. I really thought the puck was in, and of course it wasn't. The light didn't go on, and it shouldn't have gone on. Now Brian Shaw coming up and pumping one wide. He had two men with him. He had Goodwin with him and Mike Kaziski. Now the Bruins coming back. They're picking up some momentum. A shot whizzed wide. And then number 12, Kudakov tried to get in for a rebound. That's Kudakov back out in front. Here's a try. It's tipped right on the Spokane netminder. They chop at it and fall on it. And I got to say that the Grand Forks team hasn't had that margin of luck just of late.
No, they haven't. Number 12, Hudakoff there, he was standing over there at the side of that goal, and that rebound come back, and it looked for sure that he was going to put it in there. But it went just a hair wide around off the boards, and I definitely thought it was going in. He had Sam Froby all faked out over there. Sam was over on the other side of the net.
Well, I think now with the period about a third over, Froby's had six or seven saves all so far, I would think.
It seems like it'd be that many anyways.
Yeah. Here's Wright trying to roll one in front. It's in front, and Froby just pounces on it with that catching glove on the left side.
Video games are now the rage. At Video Station, you can find a complete selection of home video games by Atari, Mattel, and Bailey. Video Station also has RCA, VCRs, video disc, and accessories. The Video Station at East 701 3rd Avenue across from Freeway Chevrolet, or on North Division across from Northgate Center.
Now the Bruins bring it back up over the line as Wishlow took a shot and had very little wood on it, and Froby just covers up. You see, the right hand of Froby has the blocking pad on it. That big pad, there's a good shot, Jim. That's it. That's protected, a blocking pad that takes a lot of that, lot of saves. Charlie Goodwin now coming out with Poindexter and Danny Holden. Holden to Poindexter. Goodwin in front, and he can't get a stick on it. Then the Bruins come out of their own zone to center ice. That's Wright, the defenseman, up over the Flame blue line. Fell along with Spokane's Pregages, and they keep it in there. A bouncing puck, right going back of the goal, watched by Pregages. It's Peter or Pete. They get it back to the point. The screenshot off of Poindexter's pads, and it's in front and out to center ice. Poindexter in an onside play. He's hooked and pulled down, and a raised arm, a delayed penalty, no doubt about it. He wasn't entirely clear of the player, but he was hooked and pulled down at 7:35.
Well, he had a breakaway there. He was only had about a foot on him, but he did have a breakaway. So that's number 25 again, Rob Wishlow. He'll be skating off for, oh, excuse me, that isn't 25. Who is they going to give that to? There it is, number 14. That would be Brett Wakefield. He'll be skating off for 2 minutes.
Okay, now if you're coaching, as far as defensive hockey is concerned, Kim, and a lot of our viewers well know, that's the type of a penalty you take. You can't let that man, in this case a Spokane's Poindexter, a chance to go in unmolested and have a free shot. And so you take the penalty there. That's good defensive hockey, and hope that the team can keep the Flames off the scoreboard. You see the puck being cleared down the ice with a backhander shot. A wobbling puck stopped and flattened out by the netminder Froby. Now the Flames come back. That's number 27, Green. Here's Kurt Nelson taking a hard shot. A glove save by the netminder Bob Mall. And the Bruins bang it off the boards down inside Spokane territory.
Hey,
Kine starting out with Nelson to center, along with 27, Green, and Bailey on the left side, and a glove save by the netminder Mall. And that's Green, and was it number six?
Yeah, I think so. That penalty to number 14, Brett Wakefield, was for hooking, and that came at 7:35. He has a minute and 22 seconds left in that penalty. Time left in this period, the second period, 11:47, with Spokane leading 4-0.
Facing off to the left of the Canadian goal, that's Bailey couldn't control it, but covering up his kind, they bring it. It's offside. I think two men couldn't get onside before the whistle.
Well, there's now a minute and 16 seconds left in that penalty.
One thing, when we stand up here, Kim, you have a lot of your friends coming by and tipping their hat to you, you know. We're fully exposed here. A friend with a good-smelling cigar there.
That's correct, and I notice there's not very many of them that walk by that you don't know from somewhere.
Well, he's a friend of yours. Okay, Ewers can't hold it in the blue line. He's chased to center but starts out again with Bailey and Nelson, and the far spot there you see Green. Again, Flames in a power play. They can't control it. Here's a breakaway for the Bruins, going in and shooting and scoring is number 27, Rasmussen, for their first goal. And that's a shorthanded goal, a backfiring play as far as the Flames are concerned. You don't like to be scored on when you're sure, when you have the extra man, but that's what happened at 8:49. 27, Rasmussen, their first goal.
I believe that'll be unassisted for number 27, Rasmussen, and that came at 8:49. So Spokane now is only leading 4-1. Grand Forks pulls within 3.
That happened tonight against Calgary for Edmonton. Edmonton was power play, and they couldn't contain it. Calgary couldn't. Now the Bruins come in again, a screenshot wide, and in the one in Edmonton, it was Gretzky who scored. Here's a shot, a save by Froby, as the Bruins trying to get another shot set up there. And Jones has it. 10:48 left in the second period. The game is almost half over. Here's Nelson, or no, rather not Nelson, but Kaziski coming in on a backhander, and a good save by Bob Ball as we start to have them pushing and shoving, and this is where we don't need it. The game is as exciting as possible with that good skating, good shooting and passing, and some spectacular saves by the netminders, and both have come up with some good saves tonight. We don't need all that extracurricular after the play is stopped.
That was Keith Blair in there doing that, and Keith isn't known for very many penalties on the season. He only has 28 penalty minutes, which is rather low. So there must have been something in there that he didn't like.
And he's our leading point getter with 23 goals and 19 assists for 42 points. It's cleared down inside the Spokane Flames zone. They lead 4-1 over Grand Forks. Kine coming out slowly with Bowles, along with Kaziski and Blair. Blair cutting in center. They bang at it and miss it. Jones missed the corner, and it's cleared out to center ice. And then the Bruins started to get going there as Hudikoff tried to get something organized. And I think we had an offside infraction.
Yes, we did. One man thought he was going to get his stick on the puck, and he didn't quite get it there in time. So we had one man up ahead of him a little bit.
Kim, do you know why they don't paint the blue lines blue?
I have no idea. I think it's something that should be done. It's definitely a little bit... throws you off when you look down there, and they're all red. All three lines are red.
Yeah. However, the blue lines are blue up the side of the boards there, and that makes it a little easier, I suppose. The puck is bouncing inside the Spokane zone. It's centered by McNabb, number 9 for the Grand Forks Bruins. They keep it in there, though, and they're getting a little more. There's a cross-checker interference coming up against Shaw. Oh, you held him, I guess.
Well, we're going to have a holding penalty, and should have more than one penalty here. Well, we're having a little discussion out in front here. The assistant captain wants to get in on this.
They've opened the Bruin gate.
Yeah, we're going to have one to the Bruins also. Well, I believe it'll be for interference.
Well, I thought there was a Spokane penalty.
There was one there on Spokane, I believe. Well, I guess not. He's really arguing about it. He don't like that call. I didn't happen to catch who it was going in over there. Number 6, I guess it was.
Okay. That's Argoteau. At 10:06, number 6. We got two men in there. Just a minute now. We already had...
We got number 9 in there also.
Okay.
And
maybe
number
a misconduct.
9 is Tim McNabb.
Right, maybe a misconduct. and Argatos.
I'll get that to you as soon as I can.
No, if it is a misconduct, it has to be an unsportsman or something because they are playing two men short. So the Flames have a two-man advantage here. Poindexter coming in right in front to Holden, and he missed the net when he was right in front. Here's Holden in front again, but he couldn't find the handle. Now he's cross-checked by the defender. And no whistle there.
Okay, Tom, those penalties came at the 10:06 mark. It was to number six, Argato.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and that was for holding. And to number nine, Tim McNabb, that was for unsportsmanlike conduct. Both those penalties came at 10:06, and there is a minute and 34 seconds left in those penalties.
Okay, Brian Shaw has it. His shot bobbled wide. Poindexter fighting in there, and let's see how effective the Bruins are in killing it off. And how good the Flames are if they can score. They lead 4-1 as the Canadians dump it down the length of the ice and Ewers goes back for it. Jim Ewers, a pass to his own blue line to Poindexter, had some trouble with it and couldn't get it across to Holden. Now it's taken by Wakefield, Burt Wakefield of the Grand Forks Border Bruins, and dumped down the ice, and that's the place to put it when you're shorthanded. 58 seconds left in those double minors to the Grand Forks team. Shaw up over the line. It's called offside. He held onto the puck just a little too long and then let it go, trapping his winger.
So we have 8:43 left in the second period. The game is a little bit over half over. Spokane is leading 4-1 over the Grand Forks Border Bruins.
This number 12, Kaziski, I've watched him more tonight than I did the last game, and of course he's moved up in that line with Jones and Blair tonight. Normally Stolz is there, but Stolz, having that damaged arm with the stitches, hasn't played as much. Here's a try by Spokane's Poindexter and a good save by Maul, number 29, the goaltender for Grand Forks.
We have 44 seconds left in those two penalties, so Spokane will be playing with a power play for 44 seconds.
Physical Conditioning Center, Sports Medicine Northwest, the Army National Guard.
Flames leading. Kine at the point. Puts it in the corner to Holden. He tried to get in front as we have Wishlow fighting in for it. Here's a try by Holden, and he got part of the puck, but he was checked, and it went wide. Poindexter coming in front. Here's to Kine. Kine back to Poindexter. A screenshot. They bounces in front as some shoving and fighting in there now by Goodwin.
And Danny Holden.
Yeah, right. And I think I would be surprised if now Goodwin doesn't come off. I think maybe Holden too, but...
Well, it looks like we're going to have a couple of them coming off.
Right.
Here. It looks like number 14 for the Border Bruins. That would be Brett Wakefield.
You're right the first time.
Bert, oh,
yep.
There we go.
Yeah, a lot of changes to our viewers in the program. And
we had some misprinting, and we tried to correct everything we could. So we have number 10, Charlie Goodwin, coming off.
Okay, we'll pick up the action until you get the statistics, Kim. So, Bodman puts Kine and Bowles on defense.
Pardon me.
With Nelson and Green as the two forwards. They're one man short. While the Bruins will be... they have a delayed penalty. They have to have a delayed penalty because they're already two men short, although we only see two men in the penalty bench. So I'm not sure what's happening there. And Bruins keep it in there. A blind backhander, and it's cleared by Green. And there's something wrong with the penalty bench if each team had a penalty.
Well, it looks like we only had one penalty called there.
Okay.
That was number 10, Charlie Goodwin, for roughing. 2 minutes at the 11:46 mark.
That answers that. So now the Bruins have a power play opportunity. Here they come in front with a backhander. That was number 9, McNabb. Back to the point to Rasmussen. He scored their only goal so far. And it's over the screen into the crowd.
Well, that was deflected off of number 27's stick, Rasmussen, and it went all the way to the ceiling there. So with 7:27 left, Spokane still leading 4-1. Spokane's got a man in the penalty box, so Grand Forks Border Bruins have a power play.
And we'll have for another minute and 13 seconds. It comes to the line, not out. That's McNabb dropping it, trying to drop it back to Wakefield, and it comes all the way out down the ice as Rasmussen's outskated Nelson.
Well, we're going to have a penalty here, and I don't think the official seen all of that. He turned around in time to see Mike Green give a punch there to number 14.
Right, the penalty has to be against Spokane. It's delayed as the Bruins have a man on the ice extra to replace the netminder, and there's a stoppage there. A roughing penalty coming up to Spokane.
I don't think he's seen all of that because that wasn't initiated by Mike Green. I happen to have my eyes on that and be watching that. And Mike Green was just following up after the guy had took a couple punches at him. But the official turned around just in time to see Mike take a punch back, and that's who got called for it.
Well, maybe there's a lesson to Mr. Green that if you're going to retaliate, make sure the referee isn't looking. Okay, now the Bruins have two-man advantage as they have Goodwin and Green in the penalty bench for Spokane, so it's 5-3. Here's a shot, and a good save by Froby as Wakefield let a shot go from the far point. And when you play 5-3, you hockey fans well know, there's lots of ice for the Bruins to pass that puck back and forth around inside the Spokane zone.
That penalty to Mike Green was for roughing. That came at the 13:05 mark, so Mike Green will be setting off for 2 minutes. And the Bruins have a power play going.
Jamming in along the boards there between Kaziski and Wakefield. The play is dead. Why don't they quit, get the face-off going, and get some of the exciting hockey?
Well, we've definitely had some exciting hockey tonight. Some good scoring, some good playing. They don't need to do this now.
I was pertaining to that play right there.
That's correct. But we've got a lot of action behind the play all night tonight.
You're right. That's Wakefield. Coming to McNabb as it bounced off the skate of Hudikoff, or rather the stick of Hudikoff. That's Hudikoff back of the Spokane Flames goal. See if he puts it back to the point, and he does. Here they're coming in and shooting, score! Number 14, Wakefield. Now that was a good play by the Grand Forks team.
It definitely was. Scott Kine was in there, and he tried to block the shot, but I think all he did is ended up screening his goaltender, Sam Froby, and Sam didn't see it, and it went right into the right side of him, and they've got another score.
Power play goal. Power play goal sets nullify the penalty to Goodwin. So now the Bruins, as they trail 4-2, Spokane 4, Grand Forks 2, still have a power play and will for another minute and 22, barring any further penalties or any scoring by Grand Forks in that time. Jones checked. Now the Canadians start out, flipping it deep inside Spokane territory. Racing forward is... I'm trying to see who number 10 is there for a minute, but 19 is Pocheck. They rolled it in front. They almost put it in. Here's a try. They put it in. They do. And they've closed the gap to within one goal, if you can believe it.
So real quick here, we're coming back. We're having a little bit of discussion down there. The officials are trying to get in and get them separated. So real quick here, Grand Forks has come back within one goal. Spokane's leading 4-3 over Grand Forks, and they've got two goals in a matter of just a couple of seconds.
14:06. Boy, I'm having trouble. It was number 10 that scored it. I don't know who that is because we had 12 as Hudikoff. And Dempster was also marked 12. I'm wondering if he was number 10. So we'll change. You have a 10 there?
Yeah, I do. I do. Wally Dempster.
Oh, yeah. That's okay. That's where I get. Here's a try by number 25, Wishlow. They bang it in front. Back to the point, there's still a man advantage, and it's cleared out to center ice where Pochuk failed to clear it. Now he puts it out to the blue line to Dempster, And Dempster was the one who scored that goal, a two-line pass infraction.
Both teams are back to full strength now. I don't have that second goal. I've got the first goal. That was scored by number 14, Wakefield. He was assisted by number 12, that would be Hudakoff, and number 22, Kelly Sims. That came at 14:06.
I believe your third goal was at 14:06.
Right, that goal came at 13:43.
Right, and I think Chen got the third goal. No? Oh, he's giving you the first of the two goals.
Right.
Okay.
For a second.
Now the Bruins coming up over the line again. They've showed some vigor and momentum here in this period. Scored three goals to Spokane's one in this period. It's Spokane 4, Grand Forks 3. The Bruins now bring it back in. As Pocheck got it to the corner, Kine along the boards to Holden. Holden to Poindexter, and it's dumped off the boards. And it'll go wide of the Grand Forks goal. It'll be called back for icing against the Spokane Flames.
Okay, that third goal came from number 11, that's Motstus. And he was assisted by number 10, Dempster. And number 6, who do you have for number 6?
Well, that's another switch they had there. That's Argato.
Okay, I knew I didn't have that right. Okay, Kelly Argato. That came at 14:06, so they're back within one. We had a turnaround in the game.
Right, I thought Dempster scored it, so he must have taken the shot. It must have been tipped in then by Moutsos. Number 11 getting the third goal. So they've turned it around now. The Grand Forks team has done a good job in this period. Ewers failed to clear. They're coming in and shooting. And a blocking pad saved by Froby. They roll it back in front. Now it's kept in there by the defenseman. He's on defense, but he's been playing every position. That's Kelly Argato. Green coming out with Ted Bailey to center. On the right side, over the blue line, and shooting off the leg of Rasmussen, the Canadian captain. And Green working with Bailey, trying to get it in front. They do, a bouncing puck. That's Ewers, number 11. There's the shot, tipped in front, and they can't get the backhander. It's kept in there, another shot by Ewers, whizzing wide. Curtis Nelson trying to put it in front. A shot by Bailey, stick save by Maul. It comes back in front. Nelson turning and rolling it wide as it was deflected. I'm saying Curtis Nelson, but it's really Kurt Nelson. Brian Shaw being bumped by Nelson. His shot was ineffective, and the Bruins come back. Here's a long shot and a stick save as Rob Wishlow let one go, and Froby covered up.
And everybody's getting in on the action there. They're going to have to separate them.
That's Kelly Sims you're looking at, 22 in the orange and black jersey, the alternate captain for Grand Forks. 4-3 is the score for the Spokane Flames over the Grand Forks Border Bruins, but it was a solid 3-0 lead for the Flames after 20 minutes of play. They've only scored once here, and the Bruins have scored three times.
Let me remind everybody that Aries Video Sports does complete coverage of any local sporting event. So don't let your team be left out. Call Aries Video Enterprises.
A bouncing puck. Wakefield puts it back of the Spokane goal. Around the far side as Moutsos jumps in there for it. Now Kaziski coming back with Blair. Blair up to the Canadian line on the right side. They try to roll it in front. And it's off the boards to center ice, all the way down to Spokane blue line. That's Kine, number 7, Scott Kine, turning in front of his own goal, getting it to center. Now it's to Kaziski and to Blair. Shot and a good save by the Canadian netminder Bob Maul.
Yeah, Blair was taking a shot, and Bobby Jones was right there for the rebound, but it wasn't to be there. Ball did cover up very well.
Well, I'll tell you this, it's got to be a better third period with a 4-3 score if it stays this way than it would have been had it been a 4-0 score for Spokane.
That is correct. And also the last three or four games that Grand Forks has played, they've gone into overtime in almost every one of them.
Moutsos down the left wing is pinned in there by Kine. It rolled in front. Here's Hudakoff trying to center it. Cleared by Blair. There's going to be a penalty there to Spokane, either the netminder or the defenseman Kine. They were both in close, even though Kine went down.
Well, Scott isn't skating off, so it must come.
No, Bruins, eh? Okay.
Oh, it was 11 on the Bruins side. Number 11 is George Moutsous.
I stand corrected there, Kim.
Well, we wasn't watching that. We was watching the puck, and that was a little bit behind it there.
You're correct. Only one penalty in that play, and that was to the Grand Forks. I was watching Kine. So Shaw puts it to center. Jones coming along the boards. As Blair trailed in the play, and it came back to neutral territory. Now Ewers takes a shot, deflected a little wide by Rasmussen. That was number 27. Kaczynski tried to get it in there, and Rasmussen, the Grand Forks captain with a C in his left chest, dumped it down the ice. Jim Ewers, number 11, you're looking right at him, back of his goal. Slowly coming out along the boards, got it to Jones, to Blair, 2-on-1 with Kaczynski. Blair going in, right in front, centers it to Kaczynski. The shot, and it, I don't know where it is, it must be underneath the netminder mall. No red light.
Boy, that was an excellent play there. Blair passed it off, and Kaczynski took the shot and just couldn't quite get it in. Mall did get a chance to cover it up.
Good 2-on-1 play for the Spokane Flames on a power play effort.
That last penalty there to George Moutsous, number 11 for the Grand Forks, was for interference. That's 2 minutes at the 17:22 mark, and we have a minute and 18 seconds left in that penalty.
You're looking down at number 6, Bobby Jones, a shot by Shaw out in front. Here's another one by Jones. It looked like it went over the goal. That's Kaczynski to Blair coming out. Ewers is open in the point. So it's Kaczynski, a shot. It hit the post, apparently.
It bounced off the post and come back out. The official was standing right on top of it. So we have exactly 1 minute left in that penalty. Spokane's got a power play going.
Shaw now to Ewers. Screenshot stopped by the defenseman. Cleared out to neutral territory. They'll wait to line mates until the line mates get onside. And too eager on the right side. It was Shaw taking it over. Brian Shaw, number 2.
I don't think he was looking at Keith Blair, and Keith Blair wasn't skating too hard to get back here. It looks like he's going to change lines here.
See, talking to Mrs. Blair, Keith's mother, and a grandchild out there. Oh, I see. I didn't know that Wayne and Mrs. Blair are grandparents, but I do tonight. That's not a newborn child, I must say. Okay, here's Poindexter coming over and shooting. A bouncing puck. He smothers the rebound.
Well, it was a good thing. Charlie Goodwin was right in there, and looks like the captain for Grand Forks has given Charlie a little bit of what for. They separate them apart. That's number 27, Todd Rasmussen.
The faceoff will be conducted to the left of Maul, the Grand Forks netminder, with Mike Poindexter in there, number 15. Against number 15, Rob Tack of the... No, that's 25, rather. Let me change that to Rob Wishlow. Two Robs there, but that's a 25 we're looking at. It rolled back in the corner to Bert Wakefield, and 2-14s. The one in white is Danny Holden jamming in there and forcing the stoppage of play. Face-off really is to Spokane's advantage because it's in the defensive zone of Grand Forks. Holden now trying to get it in front. He does, a bouncing puck to Poindexter, kept in there by Corey Bowles. Rebound in the air, knocked down by the defenseman. As some action back of the play between Goodwin and the netminder Maul. Bowles to the blue line, a bouncing puck kept in there nicely by Holden, going in and tipped right in front, put it in! Goodwin getting the play from Holden, and it was the added effort by young Danny Holden, number 14, that kept on going and finally got that pass to Goodwin, and with some difficulty got the shot away, and the Bruins let up there long enough to see that goal materialize.
Well, Goodwin had his eyes open there on that one. He definitely waited for the rebound, and he was able to put it in there.
We're in the last minute of play at 19:13. We're in the last minute of play of the second period, I should add. There's the clock, 5-3, 4 Spokane, A long try by Hudakoff, number 12. And Bowles fires it around the boards.
Well, they gave that, they gave Goodwin the gold, Rod Poindexter the assist, and Scott Kine an assist at 19-13.
Well, am I blind? I thought Holden did a lot of work over there, number 14.
That's what I thought, too. I thought I seen Danny standing right there. But that's the way the score came to me, so all I have to do is just wait and see if that holds up through the rest of the night.
Well, I'd like to see the replay on that, but we'll wait to see. Maybe in my old age I'm seeing fours when I should be seeing, five for 15?
I don't know. It looked like 14 to me.
And they said, what was the scoring besides? Here's a breakout now for McNabb. McNabb going in all alone. He shoots, and a good stand-up save by Froby as McNabb slammed into him, and then they had a stoppage in the corner.
Okay, that scoring on that was number 10, Charlie Goodwin, mm-hmm. number 15, Rod Poindexter, and number 7, Scott Kine.
Well, I guess maybe I'm seeing 14s when I should be seeing 15s, but I'm not convinced. 5-3 is the score for Spokane with 7 seconds left, a chance for one or two shots. Bing, bing, if they're going to try it here. The Grand Forks team would like to close it to one goal. Here's a try. Oh, it whizzed by the corner. And it was partially screened as Wakefield came close there to scoring for the Grand Forks team. As the second period is over, and the score, Spokane Flames 5, Grand Forks Border Bruins 3.
Second period of action between the Spokane Flames and the Grand Forks Border Bruins. We had the first goal scored by number 6, Bobby Jones. That was his hat trick goal, and that was scored at the, It looks like the 40 seconds mark into the period. He was assisted by number 2, Brian Shaw, and number 11, Jim Ewers. And then a second goal was the Grand Forks first goal. That was scored by number 27, Todd Rasmussen, and that was unassisted at the 8:49 mark. Then we had the second goal by the Grand Forks by number 14, Wakefield, assisted by number 12, Hudakoff, and number 22, Sims. That came at 13:43 in the period. And then the third goal for Grand Forks, just a little bit after that third goal, the second goal, came by number 11, Matsutsus, and he was assisted by number 10, Dempster, and number 6, Argato. That came at 14:06 in the period. And then Spokane's fifth goal came from number 10, Charlie Goodwin. He was assisted by number 15, Rod Poindexter, and number 7, Scott Kine. And we up here kind of felt it was number 14, Danny Holden, but it came down to us as Rod Poindexter. That was scored at the 19:13 mark. Penalties in that period, we had quite a few. We had number 10, Charlie Goodwin. He got a penalty for elbowing at the 44-second mark. And number 11, Jim Ewers, for roughing. And I don't have the time on that. I'll have to check. We had Grand Forks' first goal by number 25, Rob Wishlow. That was for roughing, and that came, I don't have the time on that one. I'll have to get these a little bit better here. Number 19, Kerry Bowles for Spokane, had the next penalty. That was for interference, 2 minutes at the 4:25 mark. And then for Grand Forks, we had number 14, Burt Wakefield. That was for hooking at the 7:35 mark. And number 6, Kelly for Grand Forks, Kelly Argato for holding at the 10:06 mark. Also for Grand Forks, number 9, Tim McNabb, unsportsmanlike conduct, also at the 10:06 mark. Then we had number 10, Charlie Goodwin for Spokane, roughing 2 minutes at the 11:46 mark. Number 27, Mike Green, 2 minutes for roughing at the 18:05 mark. And we had number 11, George Masutus for Grand Forks, interference 2 minutes at the 17:22 mark. Now, saves in that period, we had 18 for Sam Froby. That's a two-period total of 28. And we had 13 for Bob Mall. That's a two-period total of 24. So the shots on goal are pretty even there. We'll be right back after a word from our sponsor.
If you like video games, you'll love the video station. The video station has over 60 games you can play on your own TV set with a game computer and tapes from Atari or Intellivision. See how much fun you and your family can have. Head into the video station and play it your way. The video station. East 701 3rd in Spokane, right across from Freeway Chevrolet.
Now, on cable, your stereo and TV unite to bring you video music in stereo 24 hours a day.
You better run!
TV Music Television, in stereo, you'll never look at music the same way again.
Sports Division. I'm Kim Bolton. I'm going to be talking with Bobby Stolz. Bobby got to play in the All-Star game up in Creston. Unfortunately, the East Division lost 9-6 to the West, but Bobby was voted one of the top 10 players in the league, or up in the game. And how did you like the game?
Well, it was fast and exciting. It was a lot different than playing in the regular season game.
Because of all the top players from the league, you had a lot faster game?
Yeah.
Did you find it harder to defend?
Yeah, there's a lot players with a lot better moves and just a lot faster.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you did get one assist in the game, so you did more than your share on defense then.
Well, I don't know if you can say that.
Well, you did happen to get a trophy here. This is the trophy that Bobby was awarded for playing in the game, and I know you must feel kind of proud to have that.
Yeah.
You also got a medal, but I hear they took that away from you.
Well, there wasn't enough to go around, so they took them away from the guys that had trophies.
So maybe next year you can get another one.
Yeah, I hope so.
Okay. You seem to be doing pretty good in scoring this year. Are you expecting to stay right up there with the top five?
Yeah, I'd hope so. I'm not scoring as much as I'd like to, but I'm playing a lot more defense, so.
You also, last night in the game against Nelson, you hurt your elbow. Is that going to affect you tonight in tonight's game?
Oh, I don't think so.
Okay. I think he's being a little modest. He did get 8 stitches, so he is definitely playing hurt. But you guys have a lot of desire to come out here and play every night or practice every night and then play 2-3 games a week. Last night in Nelson, tonight here, and tomorrow you'll be playing here again. So does that affect you physically? Does that get you down?
Well, by the third day you're pretty tired, but you just kept pulling together and do what you got to do.
Okay, good luck in tonight's game. I hope your elbow don't bother you too much and you get in there and get a couple goals and get a little closer to Keith.
All right.
With TVRE Sports Division, I'm Kim Bolton. I've been talking with Bobby Stolz.
Now, on cable, your stereo and TV unite to bring you video music in stereo 24 hours a day.
You better run!
TV Music Television, in stereo, you'll never look at music the same way again.
Shop TVRE, Channel 29, your Spokane real estate station.
At the Lilac City Ice Arena. Spokane is currently leading the Grand Forks Bruins, Border Bruins, 5-3. And Tom, did you notice how that goal post came in there and kind of played a little extra piece of equipment for the goalie in that period?
Boy, those can be friends of the netminder, that goalpost on each side, you know.
Definitely. With three times that time, twice for Spokane and once for Grand Forks, they rattled off the post.
I just talked to Dennis LaRue, and he told me they made a change to bring Holden in on that scoring. Did you get it?
Okay, I did kind of bring that out, that we thought it was Danny Holden, and I will definitely write that down right now.
Now, I don't know who will get the other assist there, but Holden certainly was the hard worker that set up Charlie Goodwin on Spokane's goal. That was their fifth goal. Okay, all set to go now. LaRue drops the puck at center ice. As you saw, Pregages clear the puck along the boards there. It's Peter Pregages out in defense with Klein. And it's taken now by 6 foot five Bobby Jones down to center ice on the right side. They fired around the boards to the Bruins corner on the far side. Spokane leading 5-3 as we start the third period of play. It was 3-0 at the end of the first period, and then 5-3 at the end of the second. I understand Bobby Jones is talking to a number of colleges regarding scholarships and playing collegiate hockey. It's kept, well, it really wasn't, as number six, Kelly Argoteau, tried to hold it in there, and it came off his stick into the crowd, or went off his stick into the crowd.
Well, we have 47 seconds gone in the third period. Spokane is leading 5-3. 19-13 left in the third period.
Timekeeper is Marge Sullivan tonight. Barbara Thiefault is the scorekeeper. Paul Delaney back in front of the PA microphone. And John Bailey and Dave Tiny Rogers taking care of the penalty boxes with goal judges Jim Thiessen and Dave Greaves. Now the Flames come to the attack, but it's cleared not out, though. A second try. Poindexter gets part of the stick on it. Still has it as Goodwin was in front. Kept in there. Poindexter with Goodwin off the blade of a stick into the air. Back of the goal. Wakefield trying to cover up. He's being checked by a young Charlie Goodwin, number 10. And they hold it, and we have a stoppage.
Well, we have some good play there. Goodwin was trying to get the puck held up against the board so they could have a face-off out in front of the netminder.
Good shot there as you're looking down on the jersey of number 15, Rod Poindexter. It's in the corner. Charlie Goodwin trying to center it. And Holden was checked. Now the Bruins come back up to the attack. That's Wishlow coming across the line and leaving it for their number 10, Wally Dempster, and the shot was wide. Poindexter has Goodwin and Holden on the wings to the blue line, across, offside.
Well, Danny Holden was trying to straddle the line, and he got his skate on the wrong side of that line.
Poindexter really just hanging on the puck just a second too long.
That's correct.
Well, we have one hat trick tonight, right?
That's correct. We have Bobby Jones with a hat trick. Now, that means that he'll pull right close to Keith Blair in the scoring now. They should be just about tied in points.
That makes another interesting battle within the team scoring. Wright is upset, but he has the puck, and with him is Tack. Right in front to Tack, but he was checked. His four of them went down like bowling pins. Out to the side. Here's Kurt Nelson, too, with Ted Bailey. Nelson going in with Bailey. And they bang at it right in front. The puck is loose, and part of the goal is open there. And I think Nelson should have followed in for the shot there as he was all alone. They jam in along the boards, and we stop. Have a stoppage with Jim Ewers, number 11, in the thick of it.
Well, Ewers and Bailey were out there in front of the goal fighting for the puck, and unfortunately neither one of them, all they could do is come up with sticks and not the puck. They had an open net there on that side, and they could have got it in there. I'd like to remind everybody once again that Aries Video Sports does complete coverage of any local sporting event, so don't let your team be left out. Call Aries Video Enterprises at 534-7121.
Bobby Jones, I mentioned earlier, here's a try by Kaziski. It rolled by the corner. Jones centers it. And then Kaziski, on the backhand side, really never had full control of it and went wide. They fire on the boards to right. Number four, tipped off to center ice. And you're looking at number seven, Scott Kine, the defenseman. The Flames have the Cooper All pants combination on. The Bruins from Grand Forks, the traditional jersey and separate pants style garments. They have a stoppage there, and it should be icing, and it brought all the way down the length of the ice as the Bruins make a change, a complete change.
So, with 17:20 left in the third period, Spokane still in the lead, 5-3. Some good, exciting action here. Not too much roughing, but of course, as soon as I say that, Tom, you know that that's what we're going to start having here.
Well, I have Kaziski on the right wing, Jones at center, with Blair on the far side, and the Bruins are called for icing. Back in defense, number 7, Scott Kine, and number 19, Corey Bowles. And all 5 Flames will come up inside or on the blue line of the Bruins for this faceoff. Now they're all up inside the blue line. Coming in on the faceoff, there's Skine. Screenshot rising. Tim McNabb, number 9, putting it back in the corner. It's in front end. Jones shooting and getting a good shot, but a good save by Maul. Here's some going on now with Keith Blair and Bert Wakefield. And actually, Blair took a punch at Wakefield, but Wakefield had been roughing him up back of the play, and I don't know just how much of that action that Dennis LaRue saw.
Well, I think he's seen the whole thing. The only thing he didn't see was the goalie. Keith Blair had run into the goalie, and the goalie kind of unceremoniously dumped Blair right to the ice on his back. When Blair got up, there was number 14 standing there, and they kind of had a little discussion. 14 Wakefield took a couple punches, then Blair took one back, and apparently the official seen the whole thing.
Okay, both teams will be a man short for the next 2 minutes. Bodman has Poindexter out there. That's number 15, Rod, and 10, Charlie Goodwin, with Brian Shaw, number 2 in defense, with Jim Ewers, the left defenseman, number 11. That's Ewers now has it. It got away from him, though, as he swept the puck too wide. Wishlow coming back. Now Goodwin turning. Down the right side, across the Canadian line. One hand, the stick coming in front and getting the shot away. There's a... And they're going to allow the goal, I think, because it was a delayed penalty on it, so it'll count.
Well, unfortunately, Tom, I didn't get a chance to see that one. What happened?
Well, Goodwin went around the defenseman with one hand on the stick on the right side and was pulled down and on a delayed play, and the puck went in with the Goodwin being dumped and going in with the keeper. So delayed penalty, but it will be Charlie Goodwin's second goal of the night at least, and Spokane's sixth goal at 3:23, while both teams were a man short.
Sixth goal, his second goal of the evening, scored by number 10, Charlie Goodwin. Assist to number 2, Brian Shaw.
Shaw getting the assist, but Kim will have that for you. As Poindexter comes in with Goodwin, tipped wide, as Charlie Goodwin, almost number 10, almost completed his hat trick. 16-year-old having a good night tonight on his birthday. A long shot by the Bruins as Poindexter, Rod Poindexter, and number 11, George Moutsos, are having their trouble. A shot right on, but wide. No, it was really wide, but played off the blade of the netminder Maul for Grand Forks. Coming to the attack now. Here's a shot, tipped wide, as Wally Dempster let one go for Grand Forks. Ewers in the far side. Still has it. Do we have the scoring, Kim?
Yes, we do. That was number 10, Charlie Goodwin, assisted by number 2, Brian Shaw, and that came at 3:23. That was Spokane's sixth goal. Those penalties were to number 14, Wakefield, for roughing, and number 9, Keith Blair, for roughing. Those both came at 4:03.
Okay.
And we have 33 seconds left in those penalties.
Okay. Down the ice, and the... team is called back for icing, and the face-off will be to the left of the Bruins' goal. Six to three is the score, with the Spokane Flames leading the Grand Forks Border Bruins, and I want to just leave out the border, but that's their full nickname, Border Bruins. Wearing the Boston Bruin colors, but not, of course, the Boston Bruin crest. It's brought out to neutral territory. Here they come away. Wishlow, Rob Wishlow over the line. As 15, Rob attacked was dumped, and Holden couldn't quite control the puck as it was almost entirely out of his reach. Now Kurt Nelson starting back with Holden, going in and shooting on the short side. Good save by Maul in the Grand Forks goal. Along the boards to center ice. Here is number six, Argoteau. Kelly Argoteau, he couldn't get anywhere. Kept in there by 25, Rob Wishlow. Argoteau centering it in front, and it's punched out of harm's way by Corey Bowles. They have it back in the corner there. That's Argoteau number six, and Scott Kine number seven. Here's a shot. Oh, it just got part of the skate, I think, of the keeper, Froby, to keep it out.
Both teams are back to full strength now. And as you've seen, music 24 hours a day, music in stereo. Watch and listen to MTV 24 hours a day on Channel 22 from COX Cable. So we have 14:30 left in the third period. Spokane's leading 6-3.
Wishlow against Jones outside the Spokane blue line and ends up down inside the Canadian zone. Now Grand Forks, 3-on-2, come to center ice, right up over the line on the right side with number 15, Tack in front, and it got nowhere as Kozeski lets one go to Jones, coming in front, and shoot, he scores! His fourth goal of the night. Kozeski setting up Jones, who has scored his fourth goal of the night. And I got to watch, I don't call Mike Kozeski Kozeski. You got a half a hockey player and a half a baseball player.
Yeah, right.
There.
Well, I was on attention on that one. That came at the 5:56 mark, or 5:54 mark in the period. And it was scored by number 6, Bobby Jones, assisted by number 12, Mike Kozeski. And we'll see what the other assist was.
That's Mike Kozeski assisting, Kozyski. Get it right the first time and there's nothing to it. Here's another try by Jones. It was high, though, but gloved by 29, the netminder, Maul. Four goals. That's a super Texas hat trick, I guess. You know, Kim, the original hat trick was three goals in one period. That's a true hat trick.
Well, I'm going to have to correct that. Apparently, they seen something we didn't there. That was number 6, Bobby Jones, scoring the gold. Yep. Assist by number 9, Keith Blair, and number 2, Brian Shaw.
All right. Well, let's see if they don't change that. Here's a shot. Whizzing wide. I thought Kozeski was in on the play. It's cleared off the boards, and that going back for it is Kelly Argoteau, number 6. It's 7-3 now. Spokane Flames over the Grand Forks Border Bruins. And Grand Forks come to the attack. McNabb up to the line. Still has it. He carries on, though, nicely as Hudakoff was in the thick of it. It's right on. And tipped by Hudakoff right onto Froby's goal stick. Now back the point. A screenshot wide. Off the back screen. Sims let one go. He's been playing on the wing and on defense tonight. On that try, he was on the right point. Kozeski, a lead pass, is going to be called back for icing. No, it's played by the netminder. Kept in there by Kozeski, number 12. Centered it. Here now, Kine, off the blade of the defender, number 12, Hudakoff, and went out of bounds.
Well, I wish I had the assist from last night's game, Tom. If I did, we could figure out where Bobby Jones and Keith Blair are at. One thing I did notice with Charlie Goodwin's two goals tonight, he pulls a little bit closer. Now he has 15 goals on the season. So he's also starting to get in there in the top five scorers for Spokane. Spokane has some pretty even scoring.
Right. Of course, Stolz has been ineffective tonight, not playing too much. And he was one of the top three-point getters 10 days ago. But Blair was in on that point, so he's staying matched with him pretty well. Now the Bruins coming out of their own zone to center ice. Up to the line, a drop pass as number 10, Dempster, is bumped nicely. And the Flames come back. Goodwin, Holden with Poindexter attacking. Up over the blue line. A bouncing puck right in front. And it just whizzed wide as number 14, Wakefield, bowled Goodwin over from behind. No whistle as Wakefield comes to the attack. 2-on-2. And pumping it off the blocking pad of Froby as Poindexter was upset very effectively there by number 11, Moutsos. Now Moutsos jamming in the boards with Scott Kine and helping. helping out was Dempster in there.
Tom, this would probably be a good place to get this in. This broadcast is brought to you solely for the purpose of entertainment of our audience. Any rebroadcast, reproduction, or other use of game descriptions or accounts without the express written permission of Aries Video Sports, TVRE, Channel 29, the Kootenai International Junior Hockey League, or the Spokane Flames Hockey Club is strictly prohibited. Tom, we got a good crowd here tonight.
Yeah, right, and it's been an entertaining hockey game, too.
Well, I don't think they're disappointed.
Yeah, I think the die has been cast against the Bruins now with a 7-3 lead for the Flames, but in that second period, they made it very interesting for the Flames. Now it's brought back, Nelson with Bailey and Green. Here's Green in front. Oh, and it almost was on a stick. A try by Shaw, tipped wide by the shaft of Bailey's stick into the crowd.
Boy, I thought Shaw was going to get one that time, but she just jumped high and hit Bailey's stick and went right over top of the net and over the boards.
Okay, you're looking down on John Atkins, the linesman there. I said Atkins, I should say Atkins, John Atkins. Dwight Baker is the tall official on the other side. John Atkins. It's cleared out to center ice. Here's a break for Wright. There's a penalty for charging, I think, will go against 11 Ewers as he really bowled over the Bruin player. Here's a try by the Bruins. It's wide. Back of the goal. Ewers played it, and I think he will be the one who got the penalty for charging. He came from half the rink and really hit the Bruin player.
Well, he kind of blindsided him there. The Bruin player was looking down at the ice the other way at the puck, and he hit him pretty good and leveled him. That's what we're going to have, charging. And what time was that, Tom?
9:02. So the period is almost half over. And let's see what the Bruins can do on a power play. If they could score their fourth goal here, they could maybe fuel their effort a little bit.
Well, in the second period there, they scored three goals. They scored two of them within a minute, and then they got the other one there about 4 minutes down the line. So they can come back and tire up here.
Right. Here's a backhander stopped by Bowles, who had thrown his body in the ice in front of the shot, and it's dumped down the length of the ice. There you see 27 going back for it. Rasmussen, the big defenseman for the Bruins. He's the captain. Coming out slowly, really too hard a pass, but picked up off the boards. A trailer play to McNabb, and it's taken by Corey Bowles, and it's slowed down, but does go out to neutral territory. Now they'll try it again. Rasmussen up to the line, it's bouncing in front, as they'll try to get Hudikoff to the play. It comes back to Argotro, right labeled for the corner, and a save by Froby. Here they're coming in again. Rasmussen shooting a second try. Off a fallen player and then wide as Mike Green tied up his man but lost his stick. And it's cleared out to neutral territory. Kurt Nelson trying to look for a breakout there. Now the Canadian captain Rasmussen handing it off along the wing. They take it in front. McNabb taking a shot. Number 9. And it's wide. In the corner, they're trying to get the man set up. Argotro taking a shot. It hit the player McNabb in the face when it rebounded off of Froby's stick, the netminder stick. The puck came into the face of number 9, Tim McNabb. And
well,
that has to hurt.
Yeah, they're calling for Ham out there on the ice. He did get hit right in the face. Here comes the coach for the Bruins, and he is down on the ice, and he's hurting.
Okay, see Ham
really
Hamilton
hurt.
There with assisted by young Peter Pregages there.
Well, as they're taking care of that man, let me get a little bit more business done here. The executive producer and director of Aries Sports Division is Jim McCabe. The associate producer, Dale Wilhite. Play-by-play is Tom Mabelson. Thank you, Tom. I appreciate being here with you.
You're right. It's my pleasure being here. It's kind of fun.
Okay, and I'm Kim Bolton, and we're enjoying this. 9:37 left in the third period. Spokane is leading 7-3. We have a man on the ice, so we'll be taking a couple of minutes. We have 39 seconds left in that penalty to Jim Ewers.
Let's hope that the puck did not catch him in the nose and the teeth. Let's hope that it's just a cut on the forehead, which would probably require some stitches. No, it got him in the nose area, I think, in the nose and mouth area. Maybe? No? They've got the... There is a cut. There's blood on the ice, so the number nine, Tim McNabb, has been injured, and that's his coach, Jerry Queering, helping him off the ice with the Flame trainer, Ham Hamilton.
Well, Tom, I hope we win the 50-50 draw.
Oh?
It's going to be $46, but who knows. Here comes Ham Hamilton back over to the bench. He's getting an assist from the Grand Forks player. And Ham's been around for a long time in Spokane hockey.
Can we pan the mask of one of the players there that the Flames have? There's the, you can see it from the side angle there. But had that player for Grand Forks had a mask on, he would be on the ice playing. And that's the smart thing.
Okay, we had just informed that he had a little cup right over his lip. It hit him in the top lip.
Play underway again. Cleared down the ice. Remember, the Flames are shorthanded and will be for another 23 seconds. 7-3 is the score. Spokane Flames over the Grand Forks Border Bruins. The Bruins come out of their own zone. Pass now taken by number 21, Pregame's. Bruins coming over and shooting. That's 19 Pocheck. P-O-E-S-C-H-E-K doing the shooting.
There's 1 second left in that penalty to Jim Ewers. And today's music, 24 hours a day, combining your TV and stereo, MTV Channel 22. Well, Kerry Blair won that that money there, $46, and everybody's booing him.
Okay, let's go, please!
Hey. He's an official out here quite often.
I want to say something. 21 Pete, I got to watch you don't put too many G's in there. It's Pregame's, and I think I put a G there on instead of a K. It's and of course his dad is George Pregame's. Down the ice, a shot by Blair from the right side. I think it was wide, but it was handled by the netminder safely. Kaziski.
Oh,
I know. You'll want to shoot me. I owe him an apology there, I'll tell you.
Well, Kaziski. It gets a little cold Kaziski. Out here.
Kaziski there. And that's Pregame's going into the corner. Young Peter here comes out in front. And it's gloved by Froby as Rob Wishlow let one go.
That was an excellent job by Frobe. It looked like it might have just caught the top bar there and it had a chance to go in, so he did glove it. We'd like to remind everybody, if they come out and watch the game, which it is an exciting game and it's fun to be out here, that they dress warmly. It can get a little chilly in the Lilac City Ice Arena.
Wear your socks.
Yes.
The face-off will be to the left of the Flames' goal. And Dennis LaRue, the referee, has come over to the PA bench and the timekeeper's bench, so I'm not sure what's happening. Anybody in the penalty bench?
No, I don't see anybody. Oh, I see. They need somebody to take a look at that wound there to Tim McNabb.
Okay. It comes back to right. A backhander is nowhere near the Flames' goal. Scott Kine turning, firing it around the boards to Charlie Goodwin, kept in there by Argatrol. Now the Flames come out, a lead pass intended for Holden was really behind him, and then I don't know whether it went through his skates or not, but it's going to be brought back for icing.
Well, I think that netminder Maul needs to be made an official. He's calling the play every time he comes down there in his end. He raises his hand and tries to tell him what to do.
They all do that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, in the NHL they do it too.
Okay, that's
right. So they do it in the NHL, the players have to do it down here.
Sure. We have exactly 8 minutes left in the third period.
That's Charlie Goodwin, number 10, being checked by Rob Tack, number 15. It's in front. That's Tack shooting. And Froby has it.
I don't think Frobe's seen that until it hit him in the arm there. They're going to have a little discussion down there. They're going to have to break him apart.
That's Rick Wright, number 4. And number 14 is Danny Holden.
Yeah, we got some fans yelling, let's play hockey here, and I have to agree. We don't have anybody in the penalty bench, and we don't need anybody in there right now.
7-3 is the score. The Flames over the Bruins from Grand Forks. Junior hockey, it's the only game in town in the Lilac Ice Arena.
Yeah, I know there's a lot of hockey fans out there in Spokane that would enjoy coming out here and getting in on part of this. So we have 7:49 left in the game. Spokane's leading 7-3.
Pitikoff was in there in the faceoff. As it's at center ice now. Now back to Spokane. Blue line to Scott Kine. That's Corey Bowles, number 19, trying to get Goodwin set up, but it was too far ahead of him. Danny Holden on the right side. It's kept in there. He's hit from behind, and the Bruins turn, coming out of their own zone. Three of them come to center to the Flame blue line. In front with Wright, and a nice save by Froby, and the backhander and the rebound was wide. That's Wright, the defenseman, playing right up high there in deep. As Bowles ties up Wright, there's a penalty against Bowles, I think. For now, they're really wrestling on the ice. Well, I don't know if they're fighting or what.
Well, I don't understand that. I don't understand that at all. Wright grabbed Bowles around the neck and just held on and took him right to the ice.
Getting to know you.
Yeah.
Getting
very
to know
good.
All about you.
Well, I don't know if he was whispering in his ear or what, but I'm sure he was getting to know him pretty well.
Well,
it looks like we're going to have a penalty both ways here.
I'll tell you, when they're down there fighting like that after almost 53 minutes of hockey, you can sure tell whether the other guy's wearing the right deodorant or not.
Isn't that true? Okay, we're going to have Corey Bowles skating off, and we'll have to wait for the official word as to what they're going to call that.
Well, you could call it interference. They could have called it roughing. They could have called it holding. He did a number of things. That's really a dumb penalty, you know, that the play had come out of the zone, the Flames were attacking, and here the defenseman is tying up. Wright really was playing earlier in the game on defense for the Grand Forks team. Anyway, play's underway again, 7 minutes remaining in regulation time. That's Jim Ewers fighting out with Tim McNabb, the kid that was hit on the upper lip with that puck. They come in front again, that's Kelly Sims, number 22. Now Nelson coming out with Mike Green. They get it to neutral territory. And it's the both teams. Well, we have two penalties. They did give Wright one there, right?
Yes, they did.
Okay, all right. So both teams are a man short. Here's a try now by Wakefield. Wide is starting to throw some good checks around as long as they keep them healthy and not chippy. Brought back up to the line. Sims carrying across. And it's brought out now by Brian Shaw to Jim Ewers. Ewers has Mike Green and Kurt Nelson back of the goal, where it's covered up by number 19, Rudy Pocheck, for the Bruins. Coming to the attack, to the line. They almost collide with their teammates there. McNabb almost collided with his teammate. Now it's brought out by Kurt Nelson. Trailing on the play and picking it up is Mike Green as two of them squeeze him out. And as long as the good solid body checking doesn't deteriorate to high sticking and cross checks, etc., it's interesting to watch. The Bruins attacking. Kelly Sims, a long shot, steered wide to the near point. Here's Wakefield, and he failed to get anywhere. Now it's Blair coming back. A lead pass to Jones, too far ahead of him. Going back of the goal. Jones getting it to Ewers, trying to put it in front. Blair checking him. Now Ewers to Jones, a backhander, and a nice save from close in by Maul. Bob Maul, number 29, in goal for the Grand Forks team. Ewers trying to get it to Blair. And do we have that penalties or penalties? Well, they're almost over.
They're over now.
Well, come on in and tell the fans in a moment what it was all about anyways. I should have given you a chance there.
Well, I'm just waiting for a break in the action. I'm getting caught up here.
Kaziski back of the goal to Jones. Jones is bowled over. The Bruins coming out slowly to center ice. 2-on-2 to the line. That's 25. Wishlow, you see, as number 10. Dempster tried to get in front for the anticipated pass. To the line, but not out. Into the crowd.
Okay, now we'll try to get a chance to do that. Those penalties have expired, but there was the number 4, Rick Wright, 2 minutes for holding at 12:55, and number 19, Corey Bowles, 2 minutes for roughing at 12:55. And we had a correction on Spokane's 7th goal. We did see that, right? That was number 9, Keith Blair, on the assist with number 12, Mike Kaziski, assisting. And then it wasn't, they had reported it as number 2, Brian Shaw.
Face off. with 4:33 left in regulation time as Stolz goes to the dressing room. Jim had a good shot of him there. Now the Flames come to the attack. Holden and Goodwin. Goodwin centering it. And then bounce back of the Canadian goal. Five of them jam in there. It comes out in front. Poindexter has it. Turns. Goes to the corner. Still has it. Then it's poked away from him. They fight in there. Goodwin piling in to tie Moutsos up.
Moutsos is taking a couple shots there at Goodwin. So we'll see if we'll have another penalty here. And we'd like to remind everybody, next week Spokane will take on the Creston Clippers right here in the Lilac City Ice Arena. We'll have that one for you too. So we're not going to have any penalties, they're just going to let them skate. We only have 4 minutes and 12 seconds left, and Bobby Stolz did go up to the locker room to shower up. He's hurting a little bit tonight, his elbow, he's got 8 stitches from last night's game at Nelson.
Okay, Bruins coming to attack. You see some players being upset, and they look like they want to take their last try at each other. Three under 4 minutes remaining in regulation time. 7-3 for the Flames as Rod Poindexter, 15, comes to the attack. He has Holden with him in the wing, right in front. Here's Holden going in. Oh, it didn't go in. There's a penalty against the Bruins coming up, as there was some slashing in the front of the goal there. And I thought Danny Holden had a goal there, but it just didn't get enough oomph on it to go all the way across the line.
Well, that's going to come at the 16-26 mark.
I'll try a 16-16.
There we go.
Do it.
Boy, I just don't have my calculator.
Well, you got to work magic with that clock, you know.
I didn't happen to catch who that was that went off. Well, that was number 6.
I forget, too, but that tells you I have a memory span of about 7.5 seconds.
Okay. That was number 6, Argateau. That'll be 2 minutes for slashing at the 16-16 mark.
Okay. Brian Shaw off the legs of defender and comes out to center ice, and Ewers will have to go back for it. Well, actually, the netminder, Proby, played it first and got it back out to Shaw. It's at neutral territory. Bailey fighting in there with Grand Forks Pocheck.
Well, they tie it up over there on the boards, and we'll have a face-off over there. There's 3:24 left in the third period. Spokane leading 7-3 over Grand Forks. And there's a minute and 40 seconds left in that penalty to Argateau.
From the face-off, you're looking at Brian Shaw with now Jim Ewers back to Shaw to neutral territory to Nelson at center. And a shot came back off the backboards, and Maul wasn't too sharp in that one as he left some distance between his body and the post, and the puck bounced back out there, and had there been a ricochet off the back of his skate, had he not turned around quickly enough, it could have been deflected in. Back to Shaw. A screenshot right on, and a good save was partially screened. They roll it in front, and it rolled back by the corner as Bailey let a backhander go, and it was almost on.
Well, Nelson there was tripped by the netminder, and they didn't pick that up. So, I guess it was to the blind side of the official, though. He couldn't see it happening. 3:02 left in the third period. A minute and 18 seconds left in that penalty to Argateau.
I do a lot of soccer refereeing, Kim, and you know you just can't cover all the angles.
No, you can't. You're only human. You can only see so many things going on at once.
It's Nelson 17 back to Shaw. His screenshot tipped just wide by Bailey in a good effort. They roll it in front back to Shaw. It's in front again, labeled for the corner, and a good save by the Canadian keeper, Maul. Now it's 2-on-1. They're coming in, and it's back of the puck was back of the play to Kelly Sims, and the Flames cover up. Ewers was dumped, it bounced in front. Now Shaw, a bad pass by Shaw, intended for Green, and it was nowhere near him. It's flipped out to center ice, a bouncing puck. Ted Bailey turning number 8 and shooting. Right on, stick save. Here's Mike Green centering it. And there's nobody there as Bowles comes out on defense with number 21 Pete Pregajis on the other defense. It's back of the Spokane goal. Prekogi's coming out now. A good pass to Bailey. Bailey with a slow whistle and an offside there.
Yes, it was. Kurt Nelson was charging a little bit harder than Bailey. Bailey probably wasn't charging as hard as he could, and he got a little bit ahead of him, so they called her offsides. And it was a slow whistle. Well, are we going to have another penalty here? I thought I seen him give a signal. I didn't see exactly what it was. He was right down here in front of me.
I was just saying, is Kelly Sims the alternate captain?
Well, yep, we are going to have a penalty, and that's going to be a unsportsmanlike conduct to number 25. That's Rob Wishlow, and that comes at the 1757. Or 1757. I got that one.
Boy, they've had a lot of penalties this period, you know, particularly Grand Forks. And when you're behind, you can't play catch-up hockey. Now they're two men short. Will be for 10 seconds. Bobby Jones, who scored four goals, gets it to Kaziski on the right wing, trying to center it. Jones has it again. Okay, here's a try by Jones off a shin. They roll it back in front, and they put it in. Jones has five goals tonight. He should get credit. I knew he looked tall, but I didn't think he was 6'5". But he should get credit for that goal.
Well, so Spokane's going to have another one. They're doing a good job tonight. The score is going to be 8-3. And what do you call, if you call the fourth one a Texas hat trick, what do you call the fifth one?
I don't know, just an outstanding game, I guess.
I guess that's true.
Well, he gets one more, he'll have a double hat trick. Five goals.
Well, it's that magic line again. Number 6, Bobby Jones. Number 9, Keith Blair. And number 12, Mike Kaziski. The magic line for Spokane.
And his fifth goal of the night.
Super. Now, see what maybe they changed it. LaRue is coming to the scorekeeper's bench, so maybe there is a change. Maybe there was a deflection or something, but I thought Jones got it. There may be a deflection.
Number 9, Keith Blair. Number 12, Mike Kaziski.
No, they're going to leave her like that.
Jones from Blair and Kaziski. Time 18:20.
A minute and 38 left in regulation time. It's now 8-3. For the Flames, and I don't think there's any doubt about the outcome of this game, as the puck crazily rolled in front. You could see that one. And there was no black and orange jersey to punch it home. Off the boards, kept in there. No, it isn't. A good play by Blair to keep it out. That's Kaziski going after it, being checked in there by the captain, Todd Rasmussen. Now they're coming in again. Blair trying to center it to Jones. He puts it in. He has a double hat trick. Six goals tonight. And I think the penalty was a delayed penalty coming up with one hand on the stick. He got the puck in, but Blair also had one hand on the stick as he rolled around the defenseman on the right side, put it in front, and Jones, being tied up, got enough of the wood on it to put it in. Six goals.
You can't say enough about that line. Keith Blair has assisted, had the first assist on every goal tonight with Bobby Jones.
Well, I want to say, I go way back to 1948 in Canada in January when I did my first hockey broadcast and radio. And I don't think, other than maybe some peewee division hockey, that's the first time I've seen junior or above six goals in one night. Okay, still a man on the penalty bench. We had a major there for that.
Grand Forks penalty at the 1856.
Well, I'll get the penalty here in a second.
27, team captain Todd Rasmussen, 5 minutes cross-checking. Rasmussen now 5 minutes cross-checking.
We have 55 seconds remaining in regulation time. You see the clock, the 4:51 opposite 27. That's for cross-checking. Now, cross-checking in many hockey divisions is just a minor, but in the juniors, cross-checking is a major. I think it's a good rule.
Definitely. So Spokane will have a power play from here on out in the rest of this game.
They lead 9-3. One man, number 6, 6'5", Bobby Jones, has scored six big goals tonight. Now it's cleared inside the line by Charlie Goodwin, and you may have got that announcement, Kim.
Yeah, what it was is that is a new team record for the Flames. Six goals in one game is a new team record, and that goes to Bobby Jones.
Okay, we have an offside infraction there with exactly one half of 1 minute remaining regulation time.
I'd like to thank Jim McCabe for standing up here and running our camera tonight. I know he has to be a little bit chilly up there.
Right.
We seem to have stolen all the heaters.
Serves him right. He'll be the cameraman. Next time he'll do the play-by-play and give somebody else the camera.
There you go. There's 30 seconds left in the game.
And again, it's been a treat being part of the telecast and getting back close to hockey again, Kim.
Okay.
Face-off is, the play ended up to the side of the Bruin goal as it's cleared by Wakefield, but not out. Goodwin fighting in there. Now they come back in as Holden was upset, and the Bruins clear it down the ice with just seconds left, and that'll kill off some penalties as the game is over with the final score. And a good hockey game tonight. It wasn't 60 minutes of perfect hockey, but there was enough good hockey throughout the game to make it exciting, even though the final score ended up quite lopsided, as you see there, Jim, on the scoreboard. The final score, Spokane Flames 9, and the Grand Forks Border Bruins 3.
Back and on the third period, we had definitely a good period for Spokane. Bobby Jones coming up with a hat trick. Spokane getting four goals. The first goal scored by number 10 Charlie Goodwin. That was his second goal of the night. He was assisted by number 2 Brian Shaw. That came at 3:23 in the period. And then Bobby Jones on his first of three goals in this period at the 5:54 mark, assisted by number 9 Keith Blair and number 12 Mike Kaziski. Then Bobby Jones again at the 18:20 mark, assisted by number 9 Keith Blair and number 12 Kaziski. And then Bobby Jones on his third goal, assisted by number 9 Keith Blair. That came at 18:56. One point I do want to bring out is that Keith Blair was a first assist on every one of Bobby Jones's goals tonight. So that shows how close together that Bobby Jones and Keith Blair play together. Penalties, we had quite a few. First penalty came to number 14 for Grand Forks, Wakefield. It was for roughing at the 4:03 mark. Second penalty to number 9, Keith Blair for Spokane, roughing also at the 4:03 mark. Number 11, Jim Ewers for charging for Spokane at the 9:02 mark. And we had for Grand Forks, number 4, Rick Wright, holding 2 minutes at the 12:55 mark. Then we had number 19, Corey Bowles, roughing at 12:55 mark. Number 25, Rob Wishlow, for unsportsmanlike conduct, 2 minutes at the 15:57. Now, I have to point out here that in this game, Grand Forks had 3 unsportsmanlike conducts, one in each period. Number 27, Rod Rasmussen, again, for as a major, 5 minutes for cross-checking. In the third period, we had saves in that period for Sam Frobe. He had 10 for a 3-period total of 38. And number 29, Bob Mall, for the Grand Forks Border Bruins, had 11 for a 3-period total of 35. Stars in this game, the third star was Sam Frobe, second star, Charlie Goodwin, and of course, the star of tonight's game, Bobby Jones. From the Lilac City Ice Arena for Aries Sports Division and TVRE Channel 29, this has been Hockey Night in Spokane. I'm Kim Bolton. I've been calling along with Tom Mabelson. See you next week when Spokane...
If you like video games, you'll love the Video Station. The Video Station has over 60 games you can play on your own TV set with a game computer and tapes from Atari or Intellivision. See how much fun you and your family can have. Head into the Video Station and play it your way. The Video Station. East 701 3rd in Spokane, right across from Freeway Chevrolet.
Now, on cable, your stereo and TV unite to bring you video music in stereo 24 hours a day.
You better run! You better hide!
TV Music Television, in stereo. You'll never look at music the same way again.
For Aries Sports Division. I'm Kim Bolton. I'm going to be talking with Bobby Jones, the star of last week's game. Bobby, you scored 6 goals in last week's game. You broke a record for Spokane. How do you feel about last week's performance?
I'm real happy with it. There's not a whole lot I can say. I was at the right place at the right time. Things went my way.
The Blair Jones Kaziski line is working unreal. Last night, Keith Blair had all your first assists. Kaziski had a couple of the second assists. You guys have got it together. Is that just coming from Keith playing the last 15 games or so with you guys?
Yeah, playing together a lot helps, and we've just seemed like me and Keith have been playing together ever since he came back, and we seem to know where each other's going. This works out right. When your timing is good, nothing can go wrong.
Okay. From what I understand, we have a number of colleges looking at you and the possibility of scholarships in hockey. Can you tell us what schools those are?
Quite a few from the east. They got Brown, Yale, Cornell, Dartmouth, and a couple of the military academies, and Colorado College has also contacted me.
Excellent, excellent. You go to St. George's School here in Spokane?
Yes.
Okay. Some of you people know where that's at. That's over by the Fairview Shopping Center?
Fairwood Shopping Center.
Fairwood. Yeah, right. Okay, one other thing. How tall are you and how much do you weigh?
Without my skates, I think I'm about 6'4 and a half. I weigh about 185.
Okay, well, don't think I'm short. I'm 6 foot tall, and he's definitely 6'5 right now. So, Bobby, good luck in tonight's game with Creston, and let's see another good performance out of you.
All right, thank you.
Okay, thank you. For Aerie Sports Division, I've been talking with Bobby Jones. I'm Kim Bolton.
Now, on TV.